Really grateful you have that you've made time to be here today. Thanks for that. Just as kind of to kick off the day, I wanted to show just a short video to talk about the importance of our why. And I want you to think about what your why is and what education, why you do what you do.
How do I know? A lot of people, when they think of the phrase, how do I know, they always want to put the what behind it. How do I know what I'm supposed to do? The question that you really should ask is, how do I know why I'm here? Because when you know your why, your what becomes more clear and more impactful. If you know, like for instance, people know that I do comedy, but that's what I do. My why is to inspire people to walk in purpose. So I can do comedy, I can write books, I can be in a movie, because all of it is motivated by my why. In fact, I have a new web series out called Michael Jr. Break Time. We probably just did the 6th episode. It's on YouTube. So every single Wednesday at 3:00, we drop a new episode on YouTube of Michael Jr. Break Time. What it is it's me. I travel around the country and I do stand-up comedy, in case you didn't know. And in the middle of my comedy set sometime, I'll stop and just talk to my audience. And we've been filming this, and it's pretty cool. So we're in Winston-Salem. I'm gonna show you a clip from Winston-Salem. And I'm just talking to this guy in the audience, and he tells me that he's a musical instructor at a school. So I was like, all right, you're a musical instructor. You know, can you sing? Let me hear you sing a song. So this is what happened at the last episode of Michael Jr.'s Break Time. Check it. So you're a musical director.
Cool. Yes, sir.
All right, so let me get a couple bars of like Amazing Grace. Can you do the first part of that? Go ahead.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
That bro could sing, you know what I'm saying?
All right. Now, what you give me the version is if your uncle just got out of jail, you got shot in the back when you was a kid. I'm just saying, let me see the hood version real quick, if you know which version I'm talking about. Just see if that exists. Let me see what you got.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now, right now I'm found.
Okay, here's what I want you to catch. The first time I asked him to sing, he knew what he was doing. The second time, he knew why he was doing it. When you know your why, your what becomes more impactful because you're walking towards or in your purpose.
So that's a great message. You think about what he did there. And what I really love, and I've seen that clip quite a few times, and I love how everyone around him starts to, they get so excited, and they want, and it's infectious. So his why was powerful. He was able to find the purpose in which he was going to walk there. And I just, as you're listening to Lance today, and you have an opportunity to start a new year, school years are amazing because it just always feels like it's your first shot, first opportunity with these kids, and it's their first time with you. So it's a great experience. It feels new, the dew's on the grass. It just feels like a great opportunity sitting out there waiting for us. And so maybe think a little bit about what your why is. And when you get a minute between sessions, write it down on those on a sticky note, and go put it right up there. What is my why? The reason why you teach, the reason why you do what you do. So you don't have to do that right now. I'll introduce Lance. But keep that in mind throughout the course of the day as kind of a theme. What is your why? What makes you do what you do? So I want to take just a moment with you and introduce Lance Allred. Lance Allred, someone I've known for some time. I admire him on a number of different levels. He's a remarkable individual. To tell you professionally what he's done is really something else. He's an author of 4 books. His recent book is Long Shot. Those of you that are fans of a long shot, of somebody that is has to try to make his way in the world, that's what Lance has done. His 5 principles of perseverance have led him to great successes in his life, some of which involve athletics, but other things. He's the first deaf NBA player. And he played at the University of Utah, played locally at Weber State University. He's a TEDx star. If you have an opportunity to watch his video, it's called What Is Your Polygamy? He's a remarkable individual, somebody who's got a past that he's had to work through a bunch of stuff. He's had some things that he's faced head on, and many of your students feel the exact same way. They are long shots. They're people that need someone to help them. And I know that Lance's message will resonate with you. We're really excited to have Lance Allred with us today. And if you'll just give him a round of applause, he's off and running. Lance Allred.
All right. Is my sound good? I was the AV guy for myself this morning. It's always fun being the deaf guy and doing my own sound check, so I want to make sure we're good. So what we're going to do, I guess what has to happen right now is we got to restart this to sync up with the projector, and I apologize for that. It was working okay a little bit ago. Okay, we'll let that go for a bit. We'll get the power going, all the videos, there's going to be going. But my name is Lance Allred. I have been. I met you back in 2000, which is a spry University of Utah, where does time go? So I get to share a little bit of my story with you guys and how I became the first deaf player in NBA history. I couldn't play basketball if my hearing aids in. I have to learn to play basketball in a very different way, keeping my head on a swivel, playing more of the peripheral vision, doing things that no one else wanted to do, diving on the floor for the loose ball, outrunning everybody in my 6'11" frame, things that could not be measured on stat sheets. We love our stats in this day and age, in this world of corporate America. Everyone also thinks they can quantify heart. Can't. It's funny how you sit in these arenas with all these fancy CEOs in the front rows, and they watch the athletes make the play, and they say, great job, way to make that instinctive play, way to deviate and, you know, read the defense and do something crazy, take the risk, way to be a hero. And then the very next day, they'll go to work and say, what do the stats say? Let's put everyone inside of a box. Frustrating part of the world that we live in. Everyone thinks they can quantify heart, but you can't measure heart. You can't. It's eternal. It is not able to be pigeonholed that way. So I get to go around the world now talking about leadership, perseverance, and grit. The essence of leadership is perseverance. What is perseverance? I've had many coaches around my travels around the world that were very strong-willed. But the essence of perseverance, really, what is perseverance? Is the ability to adapt. Stubbornness is the inability to adapt. So I've had many coaches that were quite stubborn, but their ability to adapt, not so good. And the essence of perseverance is grit. Essence of grit, you know, everyone loves to talk about this word called grit. What does it mean? Let's make it some mystic, fancy word that we're trying to put inside of a box. How do you measure it? Simple. Grit is choice. Do you choose to get back up every single time you get knocked down? That's it. It would blow your mind how many times I got hit on back screens that I couldn't hear coming my way. But every time I got knocked down, you choose to get back up. Why? Because you choose to. That's grit. Who here is a bad NBA basketball fan? You got one? Okay. Tim, what's the average age of an NBA rookie? 20? Yeah. I was 27 when I made the NBA. A 7 years longer than my peers. Choosing to get back up every single time I got knocked down. No time hacks or podcasts with fancy cheat sheets or algorithms. No essential oils. Choosing to get back up every single time I got knocked down. I'm going to talk about it very abstractly. People love to ask me about, there's a clicking sound. Okay, we got it? Okay. Don't apologize at all. So, give me 1 minute. I'm going to help my guy here. Thank you so much for all your effort. To get everyone's attention back. She gave her hat to the cat after she gave a ball of yarn. Gave birth to a litter of mittens. Yeah. All right. Gripping. All right. So, thank you for your patience. We'll get through this. Talking a little bit about, where was I? Oh, grit. Essence of grit is choice. She's going to give it. Say what? Oh, the polygamy part. Yes, I left you right up there. Everyone wants that part. That's a good thing. Okay. Yeah, that's my cousin. Yeah.
Which is not weird.
No. So I was born and raised in my grandfather's polygamous commune in rural Montana. And at that time, they didn't think about things called RH factor. It's actually quite common in polygamous communes. My mother is an O negative, I'm an O positive. And so when I was born, I was very yellow, jaundiced, wasn't speaking, and my mom was worried about me. And everyone just kept saying, oh, say your prayers, everything will be fine. But after the second day, I was not improving. My mom took me out of the commune to tiny Hamilton, Montana, where there was a John Hopkins educated resident who specialized in RH, because he was an RH baby himself. And he tested my liver bilirubin titer count. He said, your son should be dead. For context, at 25, most babies have severe brain damage. At 35, they're dead. Your son's at 45. I don't know why he's alive right now. I was in the incubator for about 3 weeks, and when he released me, he said I would publish this in the Journal of American Medicine, but no one would believe me. There are two reasons why I'm alive. One, I chose to be. Two, there was always someone there to help me along the way. We live in this world where people love to shame others and say, oh, I pulled myself up by the bootstraps. I did it all on my own merit. That's not true. Anyone who's ever achieved anything has had someone help them along the way. And while I've had many people hurt and betray me and throw me under the bus, I've also had many people, many mentors that have helped me along the way that I get emotional talking about. And my parents are educators. They're retired now. And I'm so excited to be here. I love it when I get a chance to speak with educators. And the story of what education did for my family. And I'll share that a little bit more with you as I go along. The show must go on. Let's have a little grit. Okay. I've had this happen to me before. We'll be all right. I'm sorry I don't get to show you some other videos. Everyone loves to see videos and get you guys engaged. But we're going to go through it. Now, my mother took me to that Hamilton Hospital we talked about. And when he released him, he told me, yeah, I would publish this in Journal of American Medicine, but no one would believe me. When I was 20 months old, everyone thought I was going to be okay, but when I was 20 months old, I was still not speaking. I was very frustrated, stabbed my sister in the face with a stiletto heel. Everyone thought I might be the sequel to Mice and Men. They didn't know what was going to happen to me. My parents took me up finally to an audiologist in Missoula, Montana. And they tested my hearing. They said, yes, your son has severe hearing loss, about 80% hearing loss. And I was fitted with the big giant hearing aids at the time, which is just analog back then, blasted sound. And I hated my hearing aids. I hated putting them in every day. I still don't like doing it. But at that time, the blasted sound gave me constant splitting headaches. And it reminded me that I wasn't normal. And my mom had me a speech therapy for twice a week until I was 15 learning to speak this way. It's exhausting, it's tiring. Every day being reminded I wasn't normal and having to be pushed outside of my comfort zone. And I made my mom's life hell. I fought back every single day. But my mom taught me the first principle of perseverance, which is accountability. And I know I'm gonna throw some words at people and they're gonna say, Lance, we already know what accountability means to me. We already know what integrity means and all these other things, but yeah. Integrity was one of Enron's three principles, right? As a basketball player, we have to go back and revisit the fundamentals, keep them sharp, and actually redefine them sometimes, figure out what do they actually mean to us. Accountability, who here is brave enough to raise their hand and tell me what accountability means to them?
It's not because we're relative.
Okay.
It's owning that everything in your life is a result of choices that you've made or you've created.
Come on, Max. Owning everything in your life is a result of the choices you made and created. All right, I'm going to give you a long shot.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you for participating. Now, my mom taught me accountability through her example. She could have very easily said, oh, I'm a victim. I got poor medical advice. They told me not to worry about the RH factor because Jesus was going to come again. Instead, she said, all I can do to ameliorate my oversight as a parent is make Lance wear his hearing aids and make Lance go to speech therapy, giving him the best position possible to live the life that he wants to live. Because already in 1980, everyone was saying, Lance, your son's going to have a very simple life. Born in that rural area of Montana, I was only deaf kid within 100 miles. There were no amenities to learn sign language. And I get a lot of flack from the deaf community. But there were no opportunities to learn that. And every day, it was hard. I challenged my mom. You know how deaf people talk like lost in the box of a fault? Or you talk like that because you feel like you're making a sound. You vibrate up into your skull. So we feel like we're communicating. And it wasn't until I got the digital hearing aids when I was 16 and I was like, oh, the diction's and parties in the front of the mouth. That's what's going on. But it's not easy because I can talk like a thought pulse on my floss. Everyone thinks I'm an idiot. Or I can talk like this and everyone thinks I'm an ass when I don't respond to them. You can't win. All my life, I've made people uncomfortable. Just by breathing, I've made people uncomfortable. But that's the price you pay when you live on the fringes. That's part of being a leader. Part of, you know what, I'm going to stand in my space and I'm going to honor the way I've been taught to see the world. And I've had a teacher I'll share a little story with about later that's a very powerful influence on that point of view that I've taken into the world. Now, there are many fun things. Well, let's talk about accountability. For me, personally, for my mom's example. There were times in my years playing overseas around the world, I'd be playing in Italy with a coach who thought it was so brilliant that he wouldn't use hand signals because he didn't want the other team to know his play. Which is silly, because if you want a good offense, the defense always has to give you something. But the coach was so afraid the other team knowing his play, he wouldn't use a hand signal. And so, instead of me saying, oh, coach, you need to bend over backwards and make me feel comfortable because my feelings are going to get hurt if I always have to read everyone's lips and figure out where they're at, and there's my job, okay, we're running 14 high because the forward's on the other corner, I got to be here, all right, position it. And that's what I had to learn to do. Understanding the world was not going to stop and start at my convenience. I knew if I wanted to live an exceptional life, I had to first understand that I was not an exception. So, every now and then, I would run the wrong play. And the coach would freak out, he'd punch his little chalkboard at the timeout and say, Lance, that's not the play I ran, are you stupid? And I very easily could have said, hey, yo, Coach Don, I need a hand signal or something. Instead, I said, you're right, Coach. I ran the bunk play. I'll make it up to you. In my 10 years of professional basketball, what is your name? Is it Amanda? Am I reading that right? Amanda. In my 10 years of professional basketball, how many times do you think I had a coach ever truly apologize to the team? Zero, she says. Close guess, one. And isn't it funny that I go around and speak to all these leadership conventions, with all these leaders in the world, and the default answer is a cynical zero. Everyone loves to talk about leadership, but their idea of leadership is the Cold War era Stalin my way or the highway. Because I'm too insecure to hear any other feedback. My one coach, my last coach, a little tiny Puerto Rican who had every right to have a Napoleon complex. He came in mid-season, because the other coach was, he health reasons, he had to leave. This coach came in mid-season, and he brought in one of his own players, and it really affected the team chemistry. We lost six straight games. That coach released his player, and then the very next day, he sat us all down and says, guys, I screwed up. I'm going to make this up to you. No half-assed, oh, it's my fault you weren't in good enough shape. It was, I screwed up. I'll make it up to you. Do you think that made me think he was weak? Absolutely not. I would have, and I still would, run through a brick wall for that man. He was also the type of coach that could take me over inside of a game and say, Lance, what are you seeing out there as a center in the middle of all the traffic that I am not seeing from my perspective over here in the sidelines? And I would tell him. Now, whether he followed my advice or not did not matter. Just the fact that he was willing to hear my perspective and what I had to say and what I had to offer. And once he accepted that feedback, I was able to then completely trust him that he would make the best informed decision he could for the greater whole of the team. Accountability is inspiring. We're dying for it. Yet we live in a day and age with social media and 24/7 news where things are going great. I was there the entire time. When things are going bad, oh, that's the previous administration's fault. Or, hey, you've always been a Golden State Warriors fan, bro? Okay, good for you. Everyone loves the winner when they're doing well. But accountability, here's the thing I love about accountability. I knew if I take full ownership of my shortcomings, and I own them, when things finally go my way, when I get that little break, I know I earned it. And it's mine. No one can take it from me. And everyone wants to take the shortcuts. Let's use an example for presidents, easy examples. Accountability, it's inspiring. Nixon, Clinton, even Trump right now, they make their lives miserable by denying, denying, denying. Reagan, Oliver North, Contragate. This is my administration, the buck stops with me. What happened to Reagan? I just loved him even more. It's incredible how so many people are afraid of accountability and the humility that comes with true accountability, which is confidence and humility are two sides of the same coin. Just as arrogance and insecurity are two sides of the same coin. When you know what you're good at, you have no problem hearing feedback, other perspectives that help you grow and continue to expand. When you have someone that can't hear any feedback, you're dealing with someone who is very insecure and living in a world of fear. Accountability is inspiring, and again, I promise you, when you own your shortcomings, your successes are truly yours. Now, there were many fun things. Oh my gosh, we got something promising happening. Are we gonna make this work?
Oh, you're saying you
did. Getting close? Okay. Okay. All right. Fingers crossed. Okay. We'll give that a second. Now, there are many fun things about growing up in a polygamous commune with my 400 first cousins running around the wilderness like Smurfs and Lord of the Flies. that I could fall and scrape my knee and get hurt, and there would always be someone there that knew my name, that would bandage me up, give me a peanut butter sandwich, and send me on the way. That sense of community is so intoxicating that you have all these other people that are drawn to this idea and this dream that you share. But there's a dark side to it as well. We're going to talk about some deeper accountability, not just the surface level accountability that I've been talking about, but deeper accountability. At the age of 5, I had a Sunday school teacher impress upon me that God had made me deaf as a form of punishment. That I had done something wrong in the pre-life, that I had to atone for some past sin that I had no recollection of. Now, what I'm talking about with accountability is the stories we tell ourselves. That story that I had to earn love, that God was angry with me, was something I took well into my 30s as a deep subconscious story. And we love our stories, no matter how badly that hot coal burns, because we think our stories identify us. They create the boundaries of our paradigm and our operating system that is our brain. And we inflict so much pain on ourselves sometimes just to hold on to our stories. I want you guys to start asking yourself, okay, what are stories that I've taken from my childhood that are still framing my narrative? That's deeper accountability. That's accountability that does not get recognition or pats on the back saying, good job. It's a deeper accountability from within yourself that says, I am responsible for the experiences of my life. I am the common denominator in all of my experiences. And the internal narrative of my thought patterns, that's my responsibility. That's deeper accountability. Second principle of perseverance. Here we go. All right, so yeah, this is my very first game with the Cleveland Cavaliers in 2008 when I joined LeBron James and company as the first deaf player in NBA history. I had done something that people said could never be done. Unable to play with my hearing aids in. My first game at the age of 14, I was ejected because the ref thought I was ignoring him. And people said, no, he's too deaf, he can't do this. But I said, watch me. All my life, people have been telling me what I can and can't do. I simply choose not to listen. I can't hear very well anyway. And here, ESPN's going to throw me a bone. Top 10 play of the night. I was the first deaf player in NBA history to hit a field goal. Face it up, bank shot. Is it winning? I apologize. Everyone's gonna laugh at me. You're gonna see video of LeBron laughing at me, but it'll come in and out. Okay, we're gonna work with this, guys. But everyone knew all I wanted to do was shoot bank shots. I was the kid that would sneak out of church on Sunday and I'd go down to the gym beneath the church building and I'd shoot bank shots off the glass because it was really quiet. No one could hear me. But it taught me to keep things simple. You see the white elbow on the backboard, you all you have to do, you can look at it. Whereas when you're trying to swish it, you have to create this three-dimensional image in your head as you aim for the back of the hoop. Whereas the backboard, you can just look at it and touch it. And so I was that guy. And everyone in all I wanted to do was shoot bank shots. Now let's catch up to where I'm at. There's some, okay. All right. So no easy way to say it, so I'll come right out and say it. I was a really good-looking kid. That's when I was fitted for the hearing aids at 20 months old. And talking about accountability. And that's like age of 5 when I had a Sunday school teacher. Integrity! Well, I caught up now. Let's roll. Second principle of perseverance. Integrity. Who here is brave enough to tell me what integrity means to them? It's my favorite one. Yes, there are incentives. I'm giving away a book. Yes. Helen.
Nobody's around, you are exactly doing exactly what you would do if everyone was watching.
Awesome. So it's being who you say you are when people are watching and when no one's watching. Right. Good job, Helen. Thank you. I'll get you that book. You got a book. So, Helen, thank you. From my parents' example, you would think that growing up in a socialist utopian society that everyone is treated exactly the same. Absolutely not. If you're Allreds and Jessups, you're royalty. But if you're Davises or Whitos, we don't really mingle with those ones. You
know, they're kind of on the wrong side of the tracks, you know. But my parents treated everyone exactly the same. And people loved them for it. And they became a threat to people in power. From my parents' example, here's how I define integrity. I ask myself a question every single night before I go to bed. Simple question. Was I the same person in every room that I walked into? Not very hard to answer. Yet most people, especially coaches and leaders that I've seen, fail this question horribly. When the cameras are on, they're Mr. Charming. But behind closed doors are Mr. Hyde. And the saying goes, no man can serve two masters. And I have, especially those two masters reside within the same psyche. Because you're like, coach, all right, you said this yesterday, but now you're saying this today. I don't know who we're following. Say what you want about Bobby Knight, that grumpy coach. He was grumpy on camera and grumpy off camera. There is integrity in that. There is, because you know what you're getting every single day. My favorite coaches were the ones that were actually consistently grumpy. Because at least I knew what I was getting every single day, and I knew that coach also would be the type of person that if the owner came and tried to have one of his players fired, that coach would stand right up to the owner. Whereas when you had the coaches that were always being chameleons, being the nice guy or being the tough guy or just making sure everyone heard what they wanted to hear, it creates a culture of double standards. And that is the quickest way to kill any team or workplace. If you're operating in a culture of double standards, because you know that anyone at any point will throw you under the bus if they have to save their own skin. Integrity. This is my favorite one. It should be the easiest one, but it's actually the most difficult one. Integrity is a promise I'll make to anyone. If you stay true to who you are, always the same person in every room that you walk into, you will get to where you need to go. Maybe not where you want to go, but where you need to go in life. But Lance, no, what about all the people who play the politics and they get the job promotion and they get all those cool trophies? Yeah, and they burn all the bridges along the way to get there. And they have no intimacy with anyone to share it with. Empty calories. Whereas if you stay true to who you are, always the same person every minute you walk into, the network of relationships you will build is far more valuable than any trophy or paycheck. My travels around the world, I have a network of people playing basketball on every continent, but if I ask them for a favor, they do it just like that. And that makes me a wealthy man. Because they knew that when Coach was losing his mind, what's Lance doing? Okay, there's Lance. He's being consistent every single day. I know what I'm getting with Lance. Consistency of character. That is integrity, and that is inspiring to people. And sometimes integrity was all I had. And on some mornings when I didn't know where I was going with my life, on this basketball career, almost ready to throw in the towel, knowing that I stayed true to who I was, I could not fail, I would get to where I needed to go, that's what allowed me to put my shoes on one more time and get back to work. Integrity is my favorite one, again, the hardest one. Because of my parents' operations in integrity, we actually had to leave the headquarters in Montana and we moved to Utah. Attended the other headquarters in the Bluffdale area. And I hated Utah at first. I was the biggest kid in the entire elementary school as a second grader. I talked funny, and people knew the Allred name was synonymous. And there's one thing, I know this sounds really snarky, but it's true. There's one thing a Mormon doesn't like, it's a polygamous Mormon. How dare you remind us of our 19th century history? Go away. And I have no control over it. I was just a kid. So, with the hearing, the speech, and my family name, huge target of bullying. Everyone said, no, Lance, you're the big kid. Well, the movies actually get it wrong. Because when you're the big kid like me, the teachers say, oh, you gotta shrink your sides. You have to be soft to fit in. Don't be too big. Don't be larger than life. Make sure everyone is comfortable. Compromise yourself to fit in. So, compounding that with the internal story that God was angry with me, I was a huge target of bullying, and I played the victim role very well, because that was my narrative, that was the archetype that was coming forward. I'm going to show you a video of me speaking at the age of 11. So this is speech therapy for 9 years, twice a week at this point. Did anyone actually hear that? No. All right. Well, basically, I've watched that video over 300 times, and I have no clue what the hell I'm saying. I hear the part about me talking about Nintendo. With my inner balance, with the hearing loss, I have the gross motor skills of a drunk man, but my fine motor skills, off the charts. Nintendo, I'll destroy any one of you, Street Fighter 2 or Mario Kart. Don't even try, forget about it, son. But I did not play basketball. The inner balance was atrocious, very shy and introverted. Third principle of perseverance, before I get into it, we'll just talk about it. Compassion. Russ, what is one of your biggest pain points in your line of work? Who gives you the most stress? You can be honest here.
Apathetic students.
Possibly sometimes parents as well. Apathetic students and parents. Apathetic students, let's talk about that. Compassion, we'll get that in a second. Compassion protects you.
What? Compassion makes you a doormat.
It makes you soft. Not really. When kids would come at me, I used to shrink my size and apologize and be a victim about it. But then one day, when these kids would come and grab my hearing aids and throw them in the bushes, an epiphany hit me. And it was, I'm going to sit here and actually just try to connect with them and ask what is going on in their personal life that is so bad that they want to come after me to make me feel worthless. Maybe their dad beats them. Maybe their mom shames them. I've learned a fundamental truth from all my travels around the world that people inflict pain because they're in pain. 90% of the world operates in fear. And the two base fears that we operate from are abandonment or entrapment. All the other fears on top of that, those are the two root fears. I will be abandoned or entrapped or imprisoned, right? 90% of the world operates with this fear that if I don't do this or do this, or if I fail, I will be abandoned. I will be disowned from my tribe. And so when people are projecting pain onto you or lashing out at you, compassion allows you to get outside of your own head and realize it has nothing to do with you. Compassion protects you. It's a very powerful thing. We need to understand that people are just projecting their own internal stories, their own internal narrative onto you. You realize, again, it has nothing to do with you, so you're not able to take it personally. So that when people throw you under the bus, when parents attack you, or when students are being apathetic, you understand that these students are being apathetic because they feel, if we actually go out and try, and I fail, I will be stupid. And people will laugh at me, and I will be abandoned. When you understand that 90% of the world operates from fear, knowing it's not about you, it allows you to get back up every single time someone throws you under the bus. I don't say this with any vindication or spite, but every coach who ever cut me in the middle of a season of my 10-year pro career, later that year they were fired. Confirming it was just their own narrative of chaos and fear. And we were all just there playing a role in their story while they created these self-fulfilling prophecies. Knowing it had nothing to do with me. Compassion protects you. It's very powerful. And it is the hardest principle of perseverance that I'm giving you. Only those with the biggest hearts can do it time and time again after your hearts have been wounded. It's easy to puff our chest and be bravado with the big brass belt buckles and shame people for not being tough and alpha and macho. That's easy. But is it brave? You know what's brave? Being able to sit with someone and actually open the heart and be authentic with them. And not spout a platitude at them. Oh, you got divorced? At least you got your kid out of it. Of course I got my kid out of it. Are you able to be authentic and go below the surface and sit with someone who's in pain and say, wow, that really sucks. I'm sorry. And I'm here to hold space with you. Because my heart is big enough to do it. People who say they're dying for intimacy, but what they think intimacy is playing roles. The movies say you gotta do this to play a role in my story and we have a happily ever after. But yet we're not fulfilled because we think role playing is intimacy. No, having compassion and going deeper and actually being brave enough to open your heart and feel it just a little bit more, that's compassion. So when people also betray that compassion, again, you realize it's not about you. Oh, I open up my heart, and people always stomp all over it. Whereas I open up my heart because I'm brave enough. Understanding that when people betray it or stomp all over it, that's their own internal narrative of fear and projection. And it has nothing to do with it. It is the hardest one. Compassion, protection. At the age of 12, my father blew the whistle on child abuse and money laundering. And we actually had to go into hiding. And my family moved. We were hiding for about 6 months, living in the wilderness in a propane cabin on my mother's side of the family, who were not religious. It was traumatic. It was hard. Lost all my cousins who were my best friends. New world, new paradigm after the whole crumbling of what you thought was true, absolute truth with the one true faith, right? All came crashing down. That year, we settled in later in downtown Salt Lake City, hiding in plain sight, and I grew that year from 5'10 to 6'4, beginning of my eighth grade year. Slept a lot. The coach saw me walking down the hall one day, like, hey, you're really tall, you should come play basketball. Okay, I don't have any friends, it'll be a good way to fit in, so yeah, let's go give this a shot. I don't want to have to really have to worry about communicating with anybody, all I have to do is put a ball in a hoop, right? Little did I know that team sports requires extreme amounts of communication. First off, I missed the 90s, look at that hair. It was a great decade. I scoured this film for about an hour trying to find new highlights, and there's a few far in between, and we'll see how many of them last in this thing that's going back and forth. So yeah, I'm gonna go for a rebound here, don't get it. A for effort, just a graceful gazelle. I took two shots, first one was blocked, second one with a little baby hook on the baseline, not bad. Basketball fans, who here can tell me, what is a big man staple? What should every big man be able to do? Did someone say rebound? My one rebound for the game, off of a free throw, mind you, not the hardest one to get. One rebound. But one thing I knew how to do without any coaching with my hearing loss, I've always watched and mimic people, whether it was the man from Snowy River coming down the mountain on his horse, or Jeff Hornacek at the time for the Utah Jazz, one of the greatest free throw shooters of all time, keeping the ball in front of his head when he shot a free throw. Without any coaching, I was an 80% free throw shooter as a big man throughout my career. Because I watched Jeff Hornacek. I watched him how he kept that ball in front of his head. Never brought it behind his head like Carlos Boozer and other people. All the way back here. And just launched that rainbow like, oh, it's not. When you keep the ball in front of your head and you have the lower arc with a softer touch, it goes back to when we were kids and our teachers taught us. When you draw the line from point A to point B on the chalkboard and point A to point C on the chalkboard, the longer line, the harder it is to keep it is in a straight line. Same thing with a basketball shot. You keep that ball in front of your head, lower arc means less distance the ball has to travel. And so there's actually more margin for error when you're just an inch or two off with the shorter distance. So that always made sense. Keep the ball in front of the pocket, keep it simple. Yet, it's making it so complicated. Bring it behind the head, there's this cool, and you're like, oh, let me help you. That's what kept me coming back. I was not good at first. Not good at all. Again, I told you I was ejected that game because the ref thought I was ignoring him. All right, who here has written down their goals?
Maybe I have goals, but I don't even know that I have them. People might laugh at me for having dreams and ambitions and aspirations.
Every goal I have written down in my life has come true in some way, shape, or form. At this time, my sister, who was 21, was just accepted to the University of Utah School of Medicine. You can imagine 10 years earlier in a polygamous commune, ultra-patriarchal, when my sister, at the age of 11, said, "Dad, I want to be a medical doctor." And everyone said, "That's cute. Girls don't get education, let alone become medical doctors." And my sister said, "Watch." And when we went into hiding, she got a letter from the P.O. box we were using that said she was accepted to the School of Medicine. So when she saw, I love her, when she saw how much of a young care about basketball, she said, "Lance, here's what you do. You write down your goals, and you put them above your light switch. And every time you touch your light switch, on or off, you read your goals out loud. Maybe a little OCD. But every goal I've written down in my life has come true in some way, shape, or form. Did they look exactly what I thought they would look like? No. My first set of goals, I, Lance Allred, with average 3.5 GPA. I, Lance Allred, would start from my high school team by my junior year. I, Lance Allred, would get a scholarship to the University of Utah. There's talk about something now that people like to make cute, the law of attraction. Newsflash, you can't just wish for a pony and then a pony's going to appear. Doesn't work that way. Here's what the law of attraction is. You write down a goal, or you set an intention or a declaration, and then you get a download that says, "This is what I have to do to make this dream come true." My download that came, "Okay, I want to start with my high school team. I want to get a basketball scholarship. I have to wake up at 5 a.m. every morning, sleeping with the old alarm clocks on my chest. I don't sleep with my hearing aids in. They would rattle and vibrate, and I'd wake up and bike through rain, sleet, or snow. Practice with my high school coach before school, even in the summertime. How many times do you think my parents had to wake me up? Zero times. I know you guys do this all the time, parents trying to live vicariously through their kids. Horribly frustrating. I had so many teammates that were trying to play basketball to make their dad happy, that the love of the game wasn't there to carry them through the stress and the pressure of the fourth quarter. So they always collapsed and buckled. The sacred charge that you guys have, and I know it's not easy because you're between a rock and a hard place. You got these parents living vicariously through their kids, and yet you have a sacred charge to help these kids find out where their passion is and help them chase it as though they're on fire. And you want to help them, and you feel handcuffed. And I'm telling you, you still got to do it. My father was the man that all in the 1980s and 90s at Alta High School, when he taught there, the gay kids would come to him. Because they knew that he would just hear them. And all of them would come back and say, "Thank you so much for holding that space and helping me figure out what my passion was." We're going to talk more about this, but what you guys do does matter. And tell you a little bit of my experiences with that too. So, that little tangent, thanks for letting me go off on that. Like I said I was going to, I read those goals every single time, and I followed my intuition, but most people stop reading their goals because it's hard. Because it implies accountability. It says, as I'm chasing my goals, the outcome rests on me. Sure, there are many other factors that will get in the way, but I'm going to keep going, understanding it's not going to look exactly how I thought it was going to look like. By the end of my junior year, started for East High School. That spring, I went to LA for a national AAU tournament. An unknown came back ranked the best center in the West. And I got my top five scholarship offers were Utah, Stanford, Kansas, Purdue, and BYU. But we just don't do BYU, right? Insulting. Oh, like Cougar fans, sit down. If God wanted me to go to BYU, he would name me all blue, not all red. You know what I mean? Let that one marinate for a minute. But this is also 1998, the year that Utah went to the national championship game. We lost to Kentucky, and I only live two blocks away from the University of Utah. And I wanted to go play for Coach Rick Majerus. And I love Coach Majerus, and I still do. If he was alive today, I would love to talk to him. Tell him thank you for many of the experiences.
At first, my relationship with Coach Majerus was a beautiful one, because even though we were no longer in polygamy, I had a deeply embedded story, deeply embedded in my subconscious, that said God was angry with me, and I had to do something superhuman, and then I'll be worthy of love. But I have to earn it. And so, I have to be the first depth player in the NBA, and then God will be proud of me. And I'm not exaggerating, but every made or missed shot in my head had eternal ramifications. That's the kind of pressure I put on myself. So you take that insatiable work ethic, mostly inspired by fear. There are many reasons why I love playing basketball. I love basketball itself. I want to make money. Wanted to pay for school. I like girls. Girls are pretty. You know, there's lots of motivations. But fear was the greatest one. Fear that said if I did not make the NBA, I would have no value to offer the world. And you take that fear and combine it with Coach Majerus, who was a brilliant X and O man, but a brutal taskmaster. He demanded perfection. And it was a beautiful relationship at first. And now I'm going to tell a story with empathy and compassion. Not as a victim, but we tell these experiences so we learn from them. And it actually helps us honor those who have come and gone. My sophomore year, Coach Majerus' mother had cancer. And he was not doing well, and I have great empathy for it. He began to unravel. And one day he had us on the baseline, he was cussing us out. And he looked at me and said, Lance, you're the worst of all. You use your hearing as an excuse to weasel your way through life, and you're just a disgrace to cripple. And if I was in a wheelchair and I started to play basketball, I'd shoot myself. But I'm an athlete, so I don't get to have feelings. Right? We're gladiators. Man up. That's what the world tells us to. So, you're taught to just bottle it in and internalize it. People don't care about your feelings, especially when you're an athlete. Bleed, sweat, die if you have to. But entertain me as my proxy of rage. It was hard. I began to break down. I actually later was diagnosed with PTSD. Every time I stepped on the floor later that season at the University of Utah my sophomore year, I had this thought in my head was, please don't pass me the ball, please don't pass me the ball, because I didn't want to be on film making a mistake. Life is just a game of mistakes. This is the fourth principle of perseverance I'm going to share with you today. Acceptance. Acceptance is a powerful thing. It does not mean we're quitting. Acceptance takes great courage and bravery, but also wisdom and compassion for yourself with accountability. I used to do this thing in my head. I'd go home at night, sleep, and lay on the pillow and beat myself up and say, oh, if only I'd made that easy layup in the second quarter, I would have had 20 points tonight instead of 18. I did this till I was like 29, 30 years old, and I had an epiphany one night laying in bed that said, well, if I hadn't made that easy layup in the second quarter, they would have had to grab the ball out of the net, step out of bounds, inbound the ball, and run a completely different play. And then we would have ran a completely different play, contingent on whether they made or missed. So who's to say after that butterfly effect moment that I would have even had 18 points? I might not have touched the ball for the rest of the night. And yet here we are beating ourselves up with these stories saying, oh, if only if I had done this when I was 18 years old, my reality would look like this and I'd be married to Bobby with five kids now. So just as it is ridiculous to think you can change the past, it is more ridiculous to think that your past would look exactly a certain way if you had done something. So acceptance is the courage to say, if I am doing the best that I can with all the information that I have in this moment, then I'm doing a hell of a job. I'm doing a really good job. And understanding that the shots don't always go your way, but that you keep playing on. The greats are not great because they're making all the shots. They just have the pure tenacity to keep playing on. Despite the initial outcome, they keep playing on. understanding that their worth is not attached to the made or the missed shot. Having the acceptance to allow it to be what it was supposed to be. I missed that shot because that was supposed to happen. How do I know that was supposed to happen? Because that's what happened. And you keep playing on with accountability. Learning from each of those. Accountability is choosing to learn. Wallowing in self-pity or shame or guilt is not accountability. That's you being stuck in the past, not able to help your teammates in the moment. Accountability is saying, this is what happened from that experience, I'm learning from it, which allows me to be present in the moment, knowing I'm only as good as my very immediate shot. Not the last six shots, but this next shot that's coming, that's the only shot that matters now. Whereas when I played, I missed my first shot, six shots, I gotta make my next six to get up to 50%, you're always playing from behind. And you'll never catch up. Whereas when you just say, that is what it is, I let it go. Acceptance allows you to be in the present to make the most informed and accountable and integrous decision possible. It's a hard one, but it's a very beautiful one when you learn to function with it and operate with accountability and discipline in that. That end of that sophomore year, I left the University of Utah. I was ready to quit. I thought I had no value. It was, I guess maybe I'll just go be, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I got one scholarship offer. I was gonna play for Weber State University. Coach Joe Cravens had at one point been an assistant for Majerus in Utah, so he knew what went on behind closed doors. I took that scholarship to Weber State University, my one scholarship. And I was shortly after diagnosed with PTSD. And a form of OCD called scrupulosity, which is a religious-based form of OCD where you pray consistently to alleviate shame, fear, and guilt. And I remember I had the red shirt that first year, so I couldn't channel it through basketball. So I was just breaking down. I wasn't even doing my schoolwork, and I was a great student. Nothing's ever gonna be perfect, so why even try? But I finally broke down, went and saw a doctor, got diagnosed with PTSD. And I remember I walked into Coach Craven's office with so much shame. Like, I let him down. I'm like, Coach, I was just diagnosed with PTSD. I'm so sorry. And he looked at me with compassion and said, Lance, you needing medication for your PTSD is the same as your teammate Brad needing insulin for his diabetes. He gave me passion, compassion. Yet we live in this culture of shame. That says, you're having a tough time mentally? Just pray harder. Or just cowboy up. You're on medication for your kidney infection for that bender you went on? Bless your heart. I hope you're okay. But your brain, which is arguably your most important organ, is having a hard time with the chemical imbalance. You should probably just tough it up a little bit, man, you know? Double standards with that. Pretty remarkable. But having the courage to go be authentic with my coach and tell him what was happening and not expecting people to be mind readers to step in and save me, but being brave enough to have open, authentic communication. The ability to communicate is one of the things I am most grateful for because I had to earn it. And yet here we are living in a world where, you should just get me because if you were my soulmate, you would get me and you would read my mind. So what people are saying is, I don't want to have to communicate. Because they didn't have to earn it. Do you know how hard it is to not be able to express yourself? Like literally, physically not be able to express yourself? If you think it's frustrating that people can't read your mind, try speaking and people can't even hear the words that are coming out of your mouth. Yet here we are expecting people to come in and save the day and read our minds. Because we're not bold enough and strong enough and brave enough to authentically be ourselves and communicate from the heart, not just from the head. I love Coach Craven. I'll do anything for that man. But I had very low expectations. Beginning of my senior year, however, I had the audacity to start writing down my goals again. I am Lance Allred. We'll average 18 points and 12 rebounds a game. I, Lance Allred, will lead the nation in rebounding. I Lance Allred will be an academic All-American. I Lance Allred will be the first deaf player in NBA history. I'm a lot lighter than I was back then, because back then, in the days of your college basketball, they had us doing the same lifts as the football players, so lo and behold, I look like a football player. But like I said, I was going to. I averaged 18 points, watched a free throw, ball in front of the head, short distance to the hoop, not very hard, thank you very much. But like I said, I was going to. Averaged 18 points and 12 rebounds a game. Led the nation in rebounding. When my season was over, I lost to Coach Krzysztofiak, who was coaching at the University of Montana at the time. I lost in the conference tournament championship game by 2 points. Ended my season at 12.0 rebounds a game, like I said I was going to, and I was number one in the country. Andrew Bogut and Paul Millsap, both brilliant basketball players, went later games in the postseason. Massive rebounding games, passed me up to 12.1. I went from number one to number three, and all I could do was watch. I only got one NBA workout after that year. That was to go practice for the Utah Jazz, because somebody had missed their flight. They already had someone else there, like, oh, Lance Allred lives up the street, let's throw him a bone. And I went and worked out, it was a good workout. I was really happy with the workout. And the guy I was working out against was so out of shape, he couldn't even finish the workout. He just dropped to his knees, and he started vomiting all over the floor. So much vomit just slowly spreading over the Utah Jazz logo. I'll never forget how much. But the Jazz still drafted him in the second round. What? Maybe because his agent was former teammates with the general manager of the Utah Jazz. Maybe his agent had three other players on the team and did everything to get them on. No, Lance! Don't go after my sports teams! I want to believe it's pure merit! Because life isn't fair. I've seen enough politics at work that when I go and pay my money, I watch those players play on the 96 by 48 square foot court, that the rules are supposed to be fair. That's why I'm entitled to throw a beer can at the TV when the ref makes a bad call. Projection. No one wanted it to be more pure merit than me, I promise. It broke my heart. But when there's that much money involved, of course it's going to be politics. Who are we kidding? When people ask me, I love you. People are so sweet. You see, you're really tall. Why didn't you go play for the Utah Jazz? I'm like, oh, if it only were that simple. I wish it was. And I had a choice. I was heartbroken. I could have been a victim and said, oh, this is rigged. Become cynical. Or instead I said, all right, I'm beginning to see in my heartbreak, I'm beginning to have a little more clarity. And I'm beginning to see the chessboard for what it really is now. I have a little bit more perspective. I'll start navigating it. My very first job as a professional basketball player was over in Istanbul, Turkey. $100,000 contract as rookie. Okay, let's go do this thing. We went and did it a little too well that in the second month of our season, we were number two in the league. And the coach and the owner, who never played basketball, is surprising how many coaches I've played for in the pro levels that actually never played basketball. And that's okay, some of them are really good. Like the Puerto Rican guy, actually never played higher level basketball. So I can't shame all of them. But the coach and the owner, I was looking at this and they're saying, wow, we're number two in the league and our center is only a rookie. Imagine if you brought in a more experienced center. Lance is only averaging 10 points right now on four shots a game. There is an American playing over in Taiwan with all the shorter people. Averaging 42 points a game. Let's bring him over, and his 42 points will replace his Lance 10. We'll replace Lance's 10. We'll go from averaging 80 to 112 points a game. Never minding where all those extra shots are going to come from. Yeah, it'll work. So the coach and the owner sit me down and say, Lance, we really love you, but we're going to release you now. But I signed a contract. If you add up all the money I'm owed for my 10 years of professional basketball around the world, it's about $900,000. From contracts that were never fully paid and on. It is a silly business. And we see those top 10% contracts on ESPN announced, and we think that's the way it is for everybody. No, it's not. It's a grind and it's hard. And I kind of pushed back a little bit, but then I said, all right, coach, well, you guys still owe me $20,000 for the first 2 months, so I haven't been paid yet. And they said, yeah, we'll mail it to you. Like hell are you gonna mail it to me? I want my wire transfer receipt before I get on the airplane. And they said, okay, meet the team trainer tonight at the 7 p.m. Ramadan bell behind the Blue Mosque in the Grand Bazaar. Sounds specifically ominous, but okay, let's go do it. Luckily, my brother was in town with me. He wanted to see Istanbul. So you got the two big giant toy heads walking through a sea of turbans. Think like Indiana Jones and Raiders of the Lost Ark. You walk in, dogs barking, chicken fighting, goats being slaughtered, people trying to sell you mugs everywhere. Like, hey, American, you want a mug? I don't want a mug. I want my $20,000. And finally, my brother and I make it to a point in the middle, and it just parts like the Red Sea. And the trainer walks up to me, my brother, takes out an envelope, opens it up, and it's $20,000 cash. And the whole bazaar comes to a screeching halt. Just like they all knew that is exactly $20,000 in that envelope. And I said, whoa, I don't want that. I just want my wire receipt. Trainer just shrugs, drops on the ground, and walks away. I picked up the cash, and the two total mafia-looking guys look invited me and my brother. So we do a bank switch. He takes the envelope, I take the cash, we split up, and these guys split up, and they start following both of us. So I see this guy tailing me, I pick up my pace, he picks up his pace, I start jogging, he starts jogging, I start sprinting down the back streets of Istanbul like a Jason Bourne movie. With $20,000 in my pocket, and I truly had this very slow, rational thought in my head, in misprint. I thought I was a professional basketball player. I don't know what this is, but this is not basketball. I scaled the cement wall, hid out next to a chicken coop for about 3 hours, and it was dark. I finally made my way to the airport. So my very first 20K marathon was of a different sort. I then went over to Spain, injured my knee in Spain. The team there said, oh, that's a pre-existing condition. We don't have to pay for that. So I went home, broke, paying for my own knee surgery after my first year as a professional basketball player, well in the red. And I was rehabbing on my parents' sofa, and my leg was up over the armrest, and it was just this moment of pure self-pity. I'm just sitting there just thinking, I thought I was a professional basketball player. Word, here's my Cadillac with spinning rims, yo. Where are my Beats by Dre? Why, oh why, am I reading all the Harry Potter books in 3 weeks on my day? That's how low it was for me. I did landscaping that summer to pay bills. After 8 months of radio silence, my agent finally called me up and said, Lance, you have an opportunity to go try out for the Idaho Stampede, the minor league team for the Utah Jazz at the time. All right, Russell, how much do you think that contract offer was worth if I got it?
Less than a teacher.
Less than a teacher makes? You're probably right. $1,100 a month as a professional basketball player. Good job.
Usually I get people saying 5 or 10.
You won the price is right. Hold on. $1,100 a month. And I still had to go try out for that job, basically for the last spot on the team. And I broke my rule of asking for help, but I'd already borrowed so much money. I borrowed money from my sister just for gas money to get up there and try out. And I tried out that first day. I was wearing the same shoes I wore the year before in Europe, because I didn't have any money to buy new shoes. Those shoes were so worn out that they ripped off the calluses on my feet. balls in my feet, and I have blood just oozing out of my shoes leaving the trail. And the coach had to kick me off, and I got went and got taped up. And for the rest of the week, I would show up an hour early, and the trainer would tape my feet, but it would just keep ripping off more skin. And when I finally made the team on the last day, the coach gave me a pair of Adidas team-sponsored shoes. I earned those shoes. Fifth principle, discomfort. Everyone says they want the American dream, but you also want to be able to stay home and watch the Kardashians and eat a bowl of ice cream. Because I'm an American, and I'm entitled to the American dream. No, you're entitled to the pursuit of the American dream. What price are you willing to pay to have your dreams come true? Everyone says they want to pay the price, but when it comes to really kind of put the... All right, that's fine. Most people, no. They don't want that. Because again, the law of attraction and everything says, I shouldn't have to work that hard. Now, if I said, I want to have the best season of my life as a basketball player and not do any weight training, wind sprint conditioning, and think I can just show up when it's time to play the first game of the season and think I won't be swept off the court, I am completely delusional. That's how most of the world operates. Oh, if I just wish hard enough and have good enough positive thoughts all the time, everything's going to go great. No. Discomfort. Everyone loves to have these stats saying, oh, what does Mask.com or someone say about this next person I'm going to, because I don't want to be heartbroken again. Heartbreak is the greatest teacher. A broken heart is the most valuable thing you could ever have. Because it gets you outside of your comfort zone. It challenges your narrative and your stories. And you learn to have intimacy with yourself. As you begin to ask questions, tough questions, about what it is you actually believe and what it is you actually really want. Discomfort is essential. If everyone's trying to avoid it. Maybe I'm lucky. But every day when my mom pushed me outside of my comfort zone, to make me wear my hearing aids, made me go to speech therapy, she gave me a high threshold for discomfort. I still hate putting my hearing aids in every day. I do. It's exhausting going through this world, reading people's lips, taking the context of a conversation in a Rocky Mountain dialect, Southern dialect, no chance in hell I'm getting that one. Rocky Mountain dialect, I can follow that, take the tone shift, the conversation, the context of the conversation, and figure out what we're talking about, and then I'll learn to respond in kind. And every now and then I keep it fresh, like, hey Lance, what movie do you want to see tonight? I would love a bowl of cold cereal. Trick sounds great. That's not what I asked you. The perks of having a deaf friend. Let's roll with it. But it's exhausting. But I was not put on this earth to be caged within my comfort zones. Comfort zones are illusions. Or where we think I have control of my life. This is my little bubble. No one's ever going to infringe on it. My boundaries. I'm going to make everyone uncomfortable with my boundaries that I think are real, so I don't ever have to step outside my comfort zone. I'm going to keep everyone else on eggshell, because these are my boundaries, which are really just control and manipulation tactics. Whereas understanding, no, when I'm pushed outside of my boundaries and my comfort zone, I'm forced to actually step outside of my own little bubble and develop empathy and compassion for others and for myself. Discomfort. Don't leave home without it. When I got that job, it turns out, I only got that job at first to be the token media guy at the end of the bench. The one who was deemed not good enough at playing time. So ironically, they said, hey, yeah, let's send a deaf guy to go do all of our communication work. Do it. And there was a stretch there I wasn't playing for 6 straight weeks. And I very easily could have cut off my nose to spite my face and said, this is stupid, I'm gonna go to law school. Instead, I said, all right, fine. I see you underestimating me. Instead of saying my feelings are hurt, I'm going to say thank you for giving me the tactical advantage when you underestimate me. I see people blowing their advantage all the time when they say, oh, my feelings are hurt. Instead of saying, wow, I'm going to blindside these people. They're not going to see me coming. So fine, I'm going to learn how to do a radio interview. I'm going to learn how to do a TV interview. I'm going to learn how to do public speaking, wearing a Dr. Seuss hat at elementary school. Reading is fundamental. I'm going to learn how to do all these things that you're pigeonholing me into. and I'm going to learn how to do them so well that they will allow me to transition out of basketball and make more money than I ever did as a basketball player. This is what underdogs do. We take people's table scraps and we turn it into gold. We're alchemists. You don't sit and pout, you wait. The thing is, in a loud arena of a fourth quarter, everyone's deaf. So in the land of temporary deafness, the permanently deaf man is king. But you have to play into the fourth quarter. Most people stop at halftime because their feelings got hurt. Or they wanted it to come easy, and it was hard. The law of attraction didn't work a month later. What's going on with that? 7 years longer it took me than my peers to make the NBA. You have to play into the fourth quarter to get that advantage. Again, this is not to say it was easy, though. I was stressed. I actually had a bleeding ulcer. I had medical bills to still pay on $1,100 a month. And my mom called me up one day. She said, "Lance, I'm really proud of you. Why do you keep doing this? You don't have to do this anymore." And without being a victim or a martyr, I said, "Mom, because I choose to. It's my choice. It's always been my choice." In a week of that phone call, starting center broke his leg. Starting power forward got bought out, ironically, the same team in Turkey, the one he played for, I played for the year before. I'm like, "Hey, yo, dog, this is a good team. They pay you, right?" I can't say that, but you'll have a lot of fun. And backup center got recalled to his NBA team. He was an assignee player. So by default, I was the only big man. And this all happened within a day, within a week, and we were flying at the airport when two guys left us to Bismarck, North Dakota. We're in our 611 frames, we fold up like sardines on these tiny SkyWest commuter jets. We fly to cold-ass Bismarck, North Dakota in the middle of January and play a basketball game. And we get to Bismarck, and the coach is all freaking out. He's like, "Lance, okay, you haven't played in 6 straight weeks. Sitting me down, everyone shooting the hoops behind me, what happened is real, heart to heart. You haven't played in 6 straight weeks, so just be a good teammate, get like 4 or 5 points off of offensive rebound, just set some screens, we signed another center, he'll be here tomorrow night, but tonight you have to start and you have to play. So let's just hold this shit together." "Okay, coach." I gave him 30 points and 10 rebounds my first game as a starter on the road in Bismarck, North Dakota. I believe in the laws of physics, that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction.
I know.
So, gave him 30 points, 10 rebounds. I believe in the laws of physics, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. If I knew if I kept putting in, I would get one shot. My number would be called at least one time. That's all I ever felt I was owed. Never felt entitled much at all. I knew if my number would be called, I'd be ready. How was I going to be ready? That for the 6 weeks when I didn't play, I had a choice to pout about it, or instead say, "Fine, practice time is my game time." And when my teammates are running ahead of me in practice for the layup on the fast break, even if they don't need me, I'm going to run with them. And then when they make the layup, I will go one stride further, and I will touch the baseline. And then I will run back. And sure, my teammates laughed at me because I wasn't being cool. But what does cool get you? A cookie? Maybe? If you're lucky? Cool never got me much. I was able to play for 40 straight minutes, not having played in 6 straight weeks. Gave him 30 points and 10 rebounds. For the rest of the season, I averaged 22 points and 13 rebounds a game, and then went to NBA All-Star Weekend in New Orleans, and I won the horse trophy. All I did was shoot bank shots for him. Just bored everyone into submission. I said, "Dude, if you shoot one more, just take it. I will take it. Because I don't have a lot of trophies. I never got an MVP trophy. I never got a participation trophy. I'm glad I didn't. Because it kept me going back one more. Again, with accountability, knowing that if I had to take true ownership of my failures, every success is mine. I earned it. Shortly after that, "You gonna try it? Is it gonna work? Hopping over the rods? Okay, sweet, yeah, let's go there. We'll show you some highlights. got your quicker rock? Super. Good. Awesome. Good save. Good save. Yeah. Okay. Let's show you the highlights. Okay. Here you go. Yeah! But 22 points and 13 rebounds for the rest of the season per game. That, again, hard work does not necessarily guarantee all of our games are going to come true, but it does guarantee us a shot. Okay. I need to get putting in, I get my one shot. Went to NBA All-Star Weekend, won that horse trophy. Then shortly after that.
Now, one of the best stories in the D-League this season was Idaho Stampede center Lance Allred getting the Gatorade call-up to the Cleveland Cavaliers and becoming the first legally deaf player in NBA history. Allred signed two 10-day contracts with Cleveland, then another contract for the rest of the season.
It was a fun day. I had done the impossible. The people said it could never be done. I had no business doing. How did I dare think I could ever do such a thing? I walk into my NBA locker room. My locker's right next to LeBron's. He looks at my D-League shoes and he says, hey, what size shoes are those, 15? Yeah, me too, here, take a pair of mine. Granted, he had a whole other locker designated for shoes. That was nice. The NBA was everything I hoped it would be. The food, never eating ramen noodles ever again. That was my staple in the D-League. Honestly, 6'11 frame, eating ramen noodles is how I got by. And those road trips, yeah, those are the best. You got the meal money for those road trip games? Yeah, I'm gonna go buy $5 football today, right? For the NBA? So much food. The travel, the perks, everything was incredible. The thing I missed the most about the NBA, towels.
Towels?
Yeah. Now, you can play in all these shoddy arenas around the world with no air conditioning or towels, and basically playing with sweaty palms. You might be playing with a bowling ball, basically. But in the NBA, I could be anywhere, on the practice court or at Quicken Loans Arena or in the restaurant or in my shower at the hotel room. I could put my hand out, there'd be some minion there ready to put towels. Amazing. So many towels. The NBA was everything I hoped it could be. Except the one thing I most wanted to be that it could not be. Could never be. My very first point in the NBA was a free throw. And I banked it. And everyone thought I did that on purpose. Because I was the bank guy, right? I didn't bank in my free throws. What happened was I step up to the free throw line in Quicken Loans Arena in front of 16,000 people. And I wound up my shot like I had 100,000 times before. The shot that kept me going, that free throw, through it all. And the thought came into my head that rattled me, which is why I banked it. The thought was this. Is this it? Is this the best that it gets? Why don't I feel any different? Sure, my ego's happy, bragging right show. But here, all I feel is fear, which hasn't changed. Still fear that if I miss this shot, I'll lose my job. Fear that I see all around me from my teammates and coaches, everyone's afraid of losing their job. Where's my happy Hollywood ending? Movies never show us what happens after that triumphant kiss in the rain and musical score. Severe disenchantment and depression kicked in. Because I had these unrealistic expectations on someone else or something else to tell me that I had worth, that I had value to offer the world. This is 2008. Later that year, the next season, the economy collapses, and most NBA teams release their 14th and 15th roster spots to save money. And I was no exception. Went over to Italy, and I nearly jumped out of a window. Because the story that I was holding on to, I said God was angry with me, that I had to do something superhuman in order to be worthy of love, was clashing with reality. And that's where most of our pain comes from. Our self-induced pain from the stories that we think our happy Hollywood ending is supposed to look exactly like this, and then I have value, and then I'm a good person. To
took a long time for me to recover from that. And I came to this place where, like, you know what, I get it. It is what it is. I'm, you know, life is, you know, we just roll with the punches. But then this happened. Oh, I lost something here. Yeah. Anyhow, it's all right. My son was born. And when I held him for the very first time, I finally understood what unconditional love is. It is something I had never allowed myself to feel. It was something I thought I had to earn. Yet if there is one truth I've learned from all my travels around the world, is this, that love is either unconditional or it's not love at all. Anything else is manipulation and control. If you don't do this, I will withhold love from you. That's not love. I remember when I held when my son was turning one, he was eating Cheerios with his dual appendages. I thought that was so cool. I was so proud of him. But then I had a thought. If I can be proud of him, why then can't I actually just be proud of five-year-old me? If an electron can be in two places at one time, as we know science shows, why then can I actually, 6'11 me, be the guy who walk into that Sunday school room with five-year-old me? Look him square in the eyes and say, you're going to do great things. I'm proud of you. That was my job the entire time. The last principle of perseverance I'm sharing with you, being a leader of your own life. Being a leader of your own life is understanding that I get to determine how I measure success. That my worth is not attached to an outcome. As a world, we're dictated. That my worth is immeasurable. That I am the one who decides that. Being a leader of my own life is understanding that I am responsible for the narratives that I choose to tell myself. These principles of perseverance work, I had to do them all over again. When I retired in 2015, because I was going through a divorce. And imagine all the stories that brought up from my youth in polygamy. That you see men in power with all the wives, because they're man enough to keep all these women happy. And I can't even keep one woman happy. What does that say about me as a man? Accountability. It is my job in a failed marriage to keep my side of the street clean and have accountability and ownership for all the stories and projections I brought into that dynamic. Integrity, that while I'm transitioning careers, becoming a motivational speaker, am I the same person in every room that I walk into, knowing that they can trust me, that I would always be consistent in character. 3, compassion, that when I'm going through the pain of a divorce, that when pain is being inflicted on me, do I lash back and punch back, or do I understand that she is also in pain? The hardest one. I choose to give compassion. Discomfort. That while I'm transitioning careers, going through the divorce, being a single father to my son, living in a basement apartment, realizing that yes, I am indeed the walking incarnation of the Chris Farley man living in a van down by the river skit. My very first big pay speaking job of $5,000, I had $27 in my bank account, and all my credit cards were maxed out. Discomfort. How uncomfortable are you willing to be to have your dream come true? Get what you want out of life. And being a leader of my own life dictates that whether I have $27 in my bank account or $1 million, my worth and my voice and my message does not change. It's mine. And I earned it. That's up for me to decide, knowing that everything is my choice. Even when people try to take my choice, it is my choice in how I either react or respond. Reacting in fear or responding in trust in life as I maneuver in integrity. This principle of the perseverance work. But the whole thing about being a leader of your own life is getting your own formula. I'm giving you what's worked for me. I'm not here to say follow my formula and make $1 million in any year. I'm here to say follow your own formula. Be a leader of your own life and develop intimacy with yourself. Choosing to operate in trust rather than fear. Fear that dictates, oh, if I don't have this, I have no value to the world. This is how so many of us operate.
as I'm wrapping up and saying goodbye now, what you do matters. When I was 1 year old, my father broke his leg twice in 1 year as a construction worker in our condo. He then, with no support from the community, went out of town, enrolled his family in welfare, and went to the University of Montana and graduated first in his class and became a school teacher. Setting a new precedent for other kids in the community to start going to public school. I had a fun time with someone on a podcast who's all about homeschooling and conspiracy theories of education, right? I was able to share with them, 90% of my cousins who grew up in polygamy that attended public school do not practice polygamy. It blew her mind. The space that you guys create for people matters. I'll tell you a story about the 10% rule. When my father told me it was about how he became the alma mater when I was starting to play basketball, he says, Lance, all it really takes is just 10% more. Not your time or your effort, but your heart. I'll tell you a story about a teacher who did 10% more. It was my sixth grade year, public school in Utah. I was on the border of special needs, but 1980s, and then you didn't think about that, right? All my teachers were really frustrated with me in elementary. I was a difficult kid, no doubt. Couldn't express myself, very frustrated. My sixth grade teacher, Mrs. Ogden, she was frustrated with me one day, held me back in recess while everyone else was playing. She was sitting there, kind of just processing. And then she came, sat next to me and said, Lance, I'm beginning to understand that your hearing loss, your brain has been forced to see the world in a very different way. And people are going to say you're arrogant, you're incorrigible, you're stubborn, and promise me you'll never change. That took her 1 minute. And 10% more of her heart. She sent me on a path and prepared me for a path where there was going to be extreme criticism, scrutiny. I still get hate mail to this day from University of Utah fans. The Rick Majerus experience. Many other hate mail. So much criticism, but she set me up to be ready for it. And last year, as I was telling the story about Mrs. Ogden, I was down in central Utah for a school teacher convention there in Richfield area. And Mrs. Ogden was in the crowd. I didn't know she was, but she was. So, where I'm going at with this, it's hard for people to say thank you. Especially kids when we're growing up in such a transactional world where we feel everything is so transactional. If I say thank you, I'm indebted to you, where I was weak because I needed your help. It's hard for kids to actually process that and say thank you back. But I'm promising what you do matters. And even these kids aren't able to say thank you. 10-20 years from now, they're going to remember when you gave that 10% more of your heart. It matters. Not your grades, not all the teaching, but are you sitting there holding space with them, seeing them as people? And they will remember that. And so, like I get to say to Ms. Ogden, thank you. I get to vicariously say her thank you all the time when I get to speak to you. Saying thank you for what you've done. Not only for kids like me, but for all my cousins and so many other people who grow up in worlds where there's no opportunities, but you create a space for them. Understanding that all relationships are just mirrors to ourselves, and you're able to be a mirror to them to let them see their value. It matters. And as I'm saying goodbye now, you made me a promise that every time you get knocked down, and you will get knocked down because of life. Life hurts. But every time you get knocked down, you promise me, and more importantly, you promise yourself, that you will get back up one more time, every single time. Guys, thank you so much. Have a great school year. Bye.
to him coming. When I was a young teacher, you know, like anybody, you're just looking to make a few extra dollars in the summer. And I don't even remember how I ended up doing this, but I somehow ended up running basketball camps for Rick Majerus, and Keith Van Horn, Mike Filiak, and Andre Miller. So they would have us hire a staff, and it was usually people that Rick said, hey, they need some money in the summer. Here's your list of people. And Lance was one of those. And, that was like 10 years of my life, running those camps and being a part of great people's lives. And it's the craziest thing as you get older, the best part of it is everybody's paths cross again. And you see people in different places and ways. And I love Lance Allred, man. He did a great job today. We really appreciate his message. Thanks, Lance. Everybody loves a Minky. So thanks, Lance. Appreciate you coming. A couple of things that before we break. Lance's message had a lot of things in it, one of which is gratitude. And these journals aren't just notebooks. I want to remind you that these can serve as gratitude journals. You know, sometimes people will take these things and talk about lessons learned, optimistic things that are the blessings you've seen or felt in your life, just things that are happening. And I really thought Lance's message underscored that and a number of other soft skills that he's talking about. Of course, you know, the three different areas that we get into in CTE, the technical skills and the academic skills, are always underscored important. But listen really to what he talked about today, and it was soft skills, employability skills, life skills, professional skills, and he learned those. And that, I love that story about his sixth grade teacher. Isn't it amazing what a minute can do? A minute or two. Certain conversations are never, you can remember them like they were yesterday. And I just thought that was great. You have those all the time. A number of years ago, sometimes you happen upon certain programs that you really start to like, and one of those was a program called Story Trek. And those of you that know me well enough know that I love a good story. And this entire program was about people's stories. And this individual would go to homes, much like many of you, they would get involved in people's lives, they'd understand what they're all about. And he has this unique ability of getting people to tell their stories and showing the kind of listening and empathy that, and every one of the stories, the same, they always start out like they don't have anything to share. And I'm so grateful that we were able to get Todd here today. Let me just tell you a little bit about Todd Hansen. He's an Emmy Award-winning TV host and producer. He currently is the host and executive producer of the show that I just mentioned, The Story Trek. Todd spent 12 years as a TV news anchor and reporter. He also produced a nationally syndicated TV show. Has done numerous commercials, tutorial videos, documentaries. He's worked as an anchor and a reporter for Fox 13 in Salt Lake and Tri-Cities, Washington. Todd started his reporting and anchoring career as a student at KBYU, and Todd and his stories have appeared on CNN, Fox News Channel, and CBS Evening News. Todd created the Story Trek for BYU TV based on an Emmy Award-winning news segment called Trippin' with Todd. Todd has won 14 Emmy Awards throughout his career. He lives in Utah with his wife, Corrine, and they have four daughters. Welcome, Todd Hansen.
Well, it's great to be here this morning. You've already had, I think, a great feast from Lance Allred, so I can just say ditto and sit down, all right? You need to be on with your day. But I think Rob would be upset, so I probably should say something. Who's excited for the new school year? Yeah. What is wrong with you people? It's been a few decades since I've been at school, and especially, junior high school. And I just remember sitting there thinking, I could not do this. I mean, I couldn't do it as a student, certainly as a teacher, thinking, you would have to get up there every day for an entire school year and say stuff. Wow. And then you have to deal with these students. And that's tough, right? Is that tough? Yeah. And now, 2019, you have to deal with parents. Yeah. And that's something back in my day you really didn't have to deal with, was parents. But I have a friend who's a teacher, and he talks about, you know, there's the lawnmower, or the helicopter parents, and now he calls them lawnmower parents. And have you heard that term, lawnmower? I've never heard that term before, but they just mow the path in front for their students. It used to be that parents didn't bother with teachers at all. And if there was a problem with a grade, the student went and talked to the teacher, and now the parent goes and talks to the teacher. Is that what it was? I don't know. But it's a different world, and bless you for what you do. The greatest people in the world are among this group today, teachers. So it's great to be here today. I don't do what you do. I tell stories. I do a little television show. It's called the Story Track. I'm going to lose some lights here, so maybe you see it a little bit better on the screen. And because of this, I'm asked to speak a fair amount. When I was a marketing dude, a sales guy, a headhunter, nobody cared what I had to say. Nobody asked me to speak. Even when I was a news reporter and anchor, maybe especially when I was a news reporter and anchor, people didn't care what I had to say. I think news reporters these days are just below politicians, as far as maybe just about, I don't know, probably below, being loathed in America. But now that I have a television show that has my name on it, people care what I have to say. I put my name on the show. Not for my ego gratification. Because when I created the show, pitched it to BYU TV, I didn't want anybody else to be hired as the host. And I thought, well, if I do that, hey, nobody else can get my job as the host. In all reality, they own the show. They funded it, so they can do whatever they want. They can hire anybody they want. So if any of you have designs for that, you can take my job someday. The operative word in my show is story. It's all about stories. I can find a story out of anyone, anywhere, anytime, no matter what the circumstance. You have to be on our show. You want to tell your story?
Right now, right here?
Yeah. In the golf cart?
In the golf cart. It's all about the golf cart.
Are we going golfing?
We could. You bring your sticks?
No. You probably have some extras.
I actually do. I'll share.
Do you live here in Vantage?
I do.
What's your name?
I'm Brian.
Brian, I'm Todd.
It's Todd. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So,
jump on?
Yes, let's go.
All right.
Let's leave the crew in the dust.
Let's see if they can keep it up.
No, don't forget about them. Let's go.
All right.
We need a little breeze. I'm
hot.
Come on.
It's about the personal time.
Yep, we need this. It doesn't matter. All right, it's just random. Brian, I have no idea where you're taking me.
I wasn't sure what would happen next. The crew didn't know what was going on. I was just pleased someone finally gave me the time of day.
All right.
And there we go.
Some kind of a story.
You know
what? Never come again.
Exactly. We're doing a story with you whether you want to or not.
There you go. Well, probably going to be the highlight of your trip.
So that was Brian Stockdale, Vantage, Washington. We got a great story out of him. And that's the way I get my stories, just completely randomly. A guy pulls up on a golf cart. I'd never seen him before. He didn't know who I was. We were out knocking doors. Really hot day in Vantage, Washington. Anybody ever heard of Vantage, Washington? Nobody? Just today. All right. Well, it's north of the Tri-Cities along the Columbia River. I didn't want to be knocking on doors any longer. I'm glad he pulled up on the golf cart. Seriously, the first person who says yes, gives me the time of day, I will tell their story. It's a really simple process. I pull a state out of a hat, I get a map of that state. I put that map down on the ground. I close my eyes, drop a marker, and go to that town. And it's usually the middle of nowhere. It's Vantage, Washington. It is Unionville, Nevada. And once I get there, I duplicate that process. If the town is big enough, I get a map of that town. I have somebody else close their eyes, drop a marker on that map. It is an amazing way to see the country, by the way. And then we go, and the first person we bump into, we tell their story. And it is amazing the stories that we end up getting. When I pitched this idea to the network, it was fascinating. I didn't know how to pitch a show to a network. And I think it took all of 30 seconds. That's exactly what I explained. And they're used to big shot production companies coming in and pitching big shot ideas. And I didn't know I was supposed to do that. I just did that. And their first question to me was, well, what's your drop rate? I'm like, oh yeah, I'm trying to be all cool. And I go, yeah, the drop rate. Well, let me do some ciphering here. The drop rate in here at 9, bring it down. Do you have a slide rule that I could use, maybe an abacus or, and I just had to say, what's a drop rate? What do you mean? And they said, well, how many stories do you do before you find one that's good enough that you can put on the show? And I said that, no, that's not the way the show works. Every story is good enough. Every person is good enough. Every story matters. I would never drop a story. That's crazy. That's what Hollywood does. That's not what I do. If you've drawn breath on this planet, you have a story to tell. You matter. That's the theory behind the story track. And that's why it's confusing for TV types, TV executives to figure out. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you're from. I don't care what you look like. I will do my best to prove that you have a story, even if you don't think that you have a story. Hi there, how are you? Shocking. TV cameras are at the door.
I don't want to be there.
The best response I've heard in a long time.
I'm just an ordinary person. I don't have a great story.
Well, we love ordinary people. We think everybody's got a great story.
Yeah.
Don't run away. It's your chance at fame. You guys want to be on TV? What's that?
Exactly.
It depends on what we're talking
What's
about,
the story?
Right?
Yeah.
What's the story? That's a good question. Hi there. How are you?
Hi.
Good. So, surprise, we got television cameras.
Okay.
We're with a TV show called The Story Trek.
Mm-hmm. No, we don't have an interesting story.
Really? That's what everybody tells me. I'll bet you've got a very interesting story.
Really?
Yeah. On the way to the next door, I noticed producer Troy chatting up some ladies. Hey.
Sorry. I got most.
Everybody's got a story. Everybody's got a story. You want to tell your story? Who wants to tell their story? Hi there. How are you?
Not too bad.
Sometimes when I knock on doors, this happens.
Really camera shy. So.
Oh, really? Yeah. And no matter how many times they tell me, they won't tell me.
So if you're interested, I'd love to get to know you.
I don't think so.
You think you're gonna pass?
Yeah. They still can't help but to tell me their story.
One of those stories.
Really?
I've already started talking.
Yeah. So what's your name?
Eric.
Eric. Nice to meet you, Eric. Oh, Tag Doug's coming. How are you?
I'm good.
Or not.
I think I'm okay.
Really? You're going to pass on that?
I don't have anything interesting to say.
And she's so right. Until she started saying stuff.
That's the word.
And every one of those people had a great story to tell. What is it about this word, story? It's just a five-letter word, simple, little, tiny word. The dictionary definition of story is an account of incidents or events. A statement regarding the facts pertinent to a situation in question. Sounds like I'm reading you your rights. There's a whole lot more to the word story. We heard all about Lance's story, a powerful, amazing story. Daniel Taylor has written a couple of books about story. He says, to be a person is to have a story to tell. He talks about how we are the product of every story that we have ever heard, every story that we have ever told, and every story that we have, not every story, but a lot of stories that we haven't even heard. And that gets kind of deep when we think about how we are the product of stories that we have never heard. I'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later, but it is amazing the power of story and how stories can change lives, stories can change civilizations, stories change the world. He says, stories turn mere chronology, one thing after another, into the purposeful action of plot and thereby into meaning. If we discern a plot to our lives, we are more likely to take ourselves and our lives seriously. If nothing is connected, then nothing matters. So think about your life as having a plot. Think about your life as something that really matters. When you think about your life as having a plot, then your life matters. Why is it, though, that we don't believe we have an interesting story? Why is it that when I knock on so many people's doors, they say, I don't have a story? But then when I sit down and talk with them, you know what? It turns out you really do have an interesting story, and it has turned out to be a part of a hit television show that's won a lot of awards, and that's just from an ordinary, boring person like yourself. It's because you do have an interesting story, but people don't think they have an interesting story. It's because we get caught up in life. We get caught up in the mundane parts of life. We get out of bed. We shower. Hopefully. Some of us shower. Brush our teeth. Hopefully. Some of us brush our teeth. We eat breakfast. We drive to work. We eat lunch. Have dinner. Do some chores, put the kids to bed, we rinse, we repeat day after day, and we don't reflect upon our lives. And it's not until some dorky guy with camera crew comes and knocks on our door that we're forced to reflect on our lives, and we think about all the accomplishments that we have had in our lives, all the things that we're trying to overcome, all the things that we have overcome, the goals that we have set, like Lance talked about. That we think about what the plot of our lives could be, what the meaning to our lives could be. Because if we don't have a plot to our lives, then our lives really don't matter. But I prove episode after episode, story after story, year after year, state after state, Emmy after Emmy, that everyone has a compelling story, which means that every one of you has a compelling story, which means every one of you has a compelling life. But that's because I interview people. And I wrap it up in a nice little bow, and I put it on television in a nice little episode, which is nice, on TV. I remember I had a conversation with somebody one time, good old boy, talking about how long it takes me sometimes to write these stories. And he's like, wait a minute. Now, you don't write, you don't do any writing on your show. You sit down and you talk to people, right? And
like, no, it takes a long time sometimes, sir, to write these. And this is my writing process. So I'll sit down in front of computers. I'll pull up Premiere Pro. Some of you video teachers, you know what Premiere Pro is. Raising hands, anybody? Yeah. So, and I'll just dump the interviews into a timeline and cut out chunks of my favorite sound bites, and then my favorite sounds from the stories. I write with sound a lot, so people doing stuff, making noises. I love noises in stories. We call it natural sound or nat sound. In film, they call it diegetic sound, if that means anything to anybody. I'd never heard that term before until I hired some film guy. He's like, well, we need some diegetic. I'm like, well, it sounds like a laxative. You can probably get that at the pharmacy. It's a personal problem I don't want to deal with. So I get the diegetic, and then I write my narration out. And, you know, that was from the guy in Vantage, Washington. I wasn't sure what would happen next. The crew didn't know what was going on. I was just pleased someone finally gave me the time of day, you know. So, and then I write the story up, and I appreciated that this guy thought it was so effortless. But to prove that it is not an effortless exercise, I need a victim. I mean, a volunteer. Somebody, okay, you can help. All right, come on up. And, okay, tell me your name. Okay, Terrence. It's nice of you to, what did you say that is? Terrence? Okay, Terrence. It's nice of you to help me out with this.
I really thought I heard Terrence, but I can't be sure. It doesn't matter. This guy looks shifty. But just wait until you hear his story.
Okay, Terrence.
I'm regretting this.
Yeah, you should, Terrence. Because this is what happens just naturally in a conversation. You know, the narrated voice just happens as we're having this conversation. I'm curious what you had for breakfast this morning, Terrence.
Eggs.
Sad. I mean, eggs and bacon, you know, my favorite meal since I was a kid was Cocoa Pebbles. I love Cocoa Pebbles. You could have had Cocoa Pebbles. But you chose eggs and bacon. Because that's okay. You know, I like to reminisce about those times when I was a teenager. Boy, and I can eat 5, 6, 7, 10 bowls of Cocoa Pebbles. I wouldn't gain an ounce. It's great to just reminisce about those. Isn't it, Terrence?
Yeah.
It's amazing. But now it seems when I eat even an ounce of Cocoa Pebbles, it's like I gain 10 bowls of Cocoa Pebbles. But, oh, we can't dwell on the past, can we? We think about today. Today? Wow. Today's a great day, because we got this cool conference going on. We're looking forward to school starting, got the kids coming in. Kind of a party, right, you know? Yeah, it doesn't work like that when we have a conversation.
Does it?
Does it really? That's awesome. And it should. I wish it did. I wish music just played like that in our heads as if from the heavens. That's the way TV shows, the way movies work, you know. Thank you, Sarah. Appreciate your time. Big hand for Sarah. Yeah, so this is what we do in television. We manipulate your emotions. We play just the right music cue. That is rock cue number one in stereo. And that was done by a composer we hired to do that. Just so you know exactly the way to feel during a certain scene during the show. And my narrated voice is recorded, it's written and then recorded, and then it's sent to an editor, so it's plugged in. It doesn't just come from the heavens while I'm talking to somebody.
The pictures from childhood don't just magically appear in front of our faces as we're talking. That would be amazing. Just drifted by as I'm talking to somebody, right at the perfect moment. The perfect reversal shot of me nodding in approval. Doesn't just happen, you know. All these things take a lot of effort to happen as we're editing a show, and it's done by a team, and I'm always very proud when it does happen. But all of this was not supposed to be my story. I wasn't supposed to be this TV guy. I wasn't supposed to be standing here today talking to you. Because that was me. Dorky, shy kid from Pleasant Grove, Utah. And as I got older, it just got worse. Yeah, the hair. I was going to talk about the hair. Thank you for mentioning that. In my day, there was this person named Farrah Fawcett. That's my Farrah Fawcett hair. My sister did my hair that day for picture day. Parted in the middle, feathered. It's pretty, isn't it? Yeah. Does anybody have a good junior high picture? People probably do. I don't. All 3 years of junior high, that is the best. I'm not about to show you the other ones. I was a dork, and I was painfully shy. That's the tiny house I grew up in Pleasant Grove. Three bedrooms, five kids, two parents. It was cramped, no basement. I remember when we converted this. This was the garage. We had a driveway there. We converted that into a family room. And that actually became my parents' bedroom. The house was so small with five kids. There were no doctors, lawyers, senators in my pedigree. Nobody had ever gone to college, anything. And at some point when we lived here, I became painfully, cripplingly shy. I don't know what it was. Might have been the bullies. One Christmas I got a BB gun. So excited for that BB gun. And the bully down the street, Justin, stole it from me and shot me as I ran away, shooting me with my BB gun. It's funny now. Oh, if I saw Justin today. The bully right across the street, Casey, would beat me up regularly. Maybe it was that that caused me to be painfully shy. I don't know. But my mother was really worried about me. Like, what would happen to this kid someday? What is he going to be? Who knows? Because I just shut down one day, especially with adults. I would not talk with adults. I had one friend, Doug. And I bumped into him 3 or 4 years ago down at Tuacon in St. George. He told me when he saw me first appear on the news, his mind was blown. Like, there is no way this kid I knew growing up was on the news. He was so shy. It was incredible. There was one day when I was unbelievably amazing. I was a big Evel Knievel fan, if anybody remembers Evel Knievel. I was jumping off that 50-foot ramp with my new bike. I was small back then, so everything seemed bigger. I was about a foot, not 50 feet. I wasn't sure what I was going to be when I grew up. My dad worked at Geneva. He was a mechanic. Like I said, there were no lawyers, doctors, senators, anything like that. I knew I was not going to be a big shot college boy. Nobody had ever gone to college. I was scared to death of going to college. But I was going to do something pretty amazing in one particular way, despite all the bullies. The incredible thing about a story is the power within a story. And when you take the time to record your story, you then have the power to change your story. And it's only when we think about our lives that we think about how we can change our lives. And I'm not saying rewrite history, I'm saying make your future happen. Here's what Lloyd Newell says about this. Some call it journaling, others call it expressive writing or creating a personal mission statement. Whatever it's called, something happens when we take time to seriously ponder our life and then write about who we are, what direction we want our life to take, what our goals and aspirations are for the future. Studies have shown that writing about our personal experiences can improve our mood and even our physical health. Great reason to write down our goals. But perhaps one of the greatest benefits of writing about our lives is expressed in this statement attributed to author Bernard DeVoto. The best reason for putting anything down on paper is that one may then change it. Writing our personal story not only helps us to understand that story better, but it can also impel us to make the story better. After all, as any good English teacher will tell you, the most important part of the writing process is rewriting. Nobody's book of life is quite ready for publication yet. We're all rough drafts for now. The process of writing and revising our life story, one that is authentic and real, gives us the chance to reframe the past even as we look forward to a brighter future. So, whatever story you're living right now, whatever heartache you're dealing with, whatever challenge seems unbearable, whatever the class, whatever the physical challenge, whatever the mental challenge, whatever the whatever, just know that the story you're living right now isn't your story. It's only a chapter. And that's something that you need to know. That's something that your students need to know. That's something that your family needs to know. It's only a chapter. And this chapter of your life is not your story. Stories are always changing. And if you want a better story, it can happen tomorrow. And if life is going great, and you can't imagine how it could get any better, it can change tomorrow, and you need to be ready for it. Life can change tomorrow, life can change today. We can decide today to change something, one thing that can dramatically change your entire life. Do one thing today that the tomorrow you will be proud of. I interviewed somebody recently who was addicted, who was in the depths of despair, depression, who had committed suicide. The one thing he changed was one thing that last talked about. He decided, I'm going to get up every morning at 5 a.m. That's the one thing he did. Completely changed his life. Now he inspires others. He trains others. He's an incredible man because he made one change. He just did one thing that changed his entire life. So it's amazing how life changes in an instant, sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worse. The future isn't written. No matter how or what you think is destined for your life, life probably has a different plan. And I had a plan for my life, the shy, dorky kid growing up in Pleasant Grove who didn't want to go to college. I was terrified to go to college. I didn't think I was smart enough to go to college. Geneva shut down. They closed their doors. So what am I going to do? I can't go work in Geneva with my dad. Well, like a lot of kids, my future plans, my dreams, was to do something amazing in a different way. And that was to play football for the greatest football team to ever grace the gridiron. You know who that is? Professional. I was going to play professional football.
Bell Bears.
Let's give this man a hand. Thank you. Thank you. Dallas Cowboys. I heard it from one person. My new best friend. Right over here in the corner. What's your name?
Tyler.
Can he get a raise? Anyway. They lost their first preseason game. Preseason doesn't matter. No big deal. They won a playoff game last year. When was the last time that happened? When was the last time they made it in the playoffs? They won. I was there. I'd never been to an NFL football game. Since I was a little boy, I've been to Dallas Cowboys. Just because my brother was. That's how it works in Utah, right? You don't have a team in Utah. So you find somebody who's a fan or some you saw a game once on TV. Okay, I'll cheer for them. So that's how it worked with me. And I've been a Dallas Cowboys fan ever since. I finally went to an NFL game, and it was in Texas Stadium, AT&T Stadium. And it was a playoff game, which, like I said, it's been a long time since they've been in the playoffs. And not only was it a playoff game, but they won. It was my first game. It was a spiritual experience, I'm telling you. It was amazing for me. So those were my plans. I loved football. There's nothing. I wanted to be Lance Allred. I wanted to be a professional athlete more than anything. And you know what? I was pretty good. Yeah. Number 36. That was me. Look at that beast. You know? Played both ways. Offense, defense, running back, middle linebacker. Yeah. That was ninth grade. Yeah. I was pretty fast, had pretty good hands. People had a hard time tackling me. Ninth grade, a couple of college scouts came to a couple of my games. Wouldn't lie to you. I don't think they were there to see me. But that's what I tell my kids. It's all how you spin things. And people thought, when this kid becomes a senior, he is going to be un-stinking-stoppable. Well, I had a couple of problems with my football career. I think the very day that picture was taken, I stopped growing. I have two brothers, both quite a bit taller than me. My dad's taller than me. I was the runt of the family. I didn't play sports. Love sports. Why does this happen to me? I had another problem with football. I don't think anybody's knees are meant for football, especially mine. That was my third knee surgery in high school. That was my final knee surgery in high school. That was when the doctors said, you're finished with football. Don't play football anymore. I was after my junior year, I was tackled in a game against Payson High School, carried off the field, surgery 2 days later, screw in the knee. And they said, dude, you can't play your senior year. Well, what was amazing about me, being this brilliant teenager, I knew more than doctors at that point. So I went out to my first practice of senior year football, August, hot day, and a miracle happened. I blew out my knee. The doctors were right. Imagine that. They knew more than me. God had a different plan for me. I had some other plans. Not many. Didn't want to go to college, like I said. Scared to death of that. Had this other plan to do one other thing with my life. And that was to be a missionary for my church. So here I am. I think the picture got a little better after junior high. There I am with my trainer, and I was having a problem with the mission too, because I don't know what the expectations are in 2019, but when I went on a mission, they expected you to talk to people. And that was my biggest fear. Harking back to the childhood, I hadn't gotten over this shyness. So, but I desperately wanted to be a missionary. I thought that'd be a really cool thing. And first day out, tracting, knocking on doors, talking to people, absolutely terrified. But after a little while, I thought, hey, this isn't so bad, because my trainer there was knocking on all the doors. And this was, you wouldn't believe where it was, Sunset Boulevard, of all places, in Greenwood, Indiana. You saw the corner. So I took a picture of Sunset Boulevard, Lawndale Drive. It wasn't California. That would have been cool. Like, I opened up my mission call. Indiana. I didn't even know where that was on the map. So went to Indiana, terrified. He's knocking on all the doors. And I thought, okay, this isn't so bad. But then he says, you know, the next door is yours. And I'm trying to think, how can I get out of this? And this was before cell phones. I couldn't call 911. I thought, oh man, I could fake knee injury, you know, to land. Like, oh, we have to go back. So no. And then I thought, I'm going to, flattery will get me everywhere. So, like, hey, you know what? I think you should keep doing these door approaches. And you're like, no, because you're so good. You are amazing. I'm like, I'm learning so much from you. They should do videos of you doing door approaches and just send them all around the world to all the missionaries, because you are so great. And then he just says, no, you need to do it. You need to get it over with. And it'll get easier, I promise. And I was really worried about the public relations nightmare for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints when the headlines read, Mormon missionary drops dead on porch, Greenwood, Indiana. Because I knew that's what would happen if I had to knock on the door. But I knew I wouldn't get out of it, so I walked up to that door, and a miracle happened. I didn't die. I have no memory of what happened at that door. I honestly have no idea. I don't know if they laughed at me, yelled at me. I don't know if nobody was home. Eventually somebody was home. Got a lot of doors slammed in my face. Got a lot of people yelling at me in Indiana. But I realized these people don't know me. And he was right. It got easier. And it got easier quickly. And I started to get over this shyness. Tell you what, if you want to change somebody's life, you want to make a man out of somebody, give them a black suit and a blue suit, a couple of pairs of shoes, some scriptures, 2 weeks of training, send them a couple thousand miles away, and say, go convert people. Change my life. I started to really be able to connect with people and teach people and actually connect with people on like a spiritual level, which was amazing. I became a leader in my mission. And I got to be the person that I always wanted to be, but I was too afraid to be earlier because of my shyness. It was incredible for me, an amazing experience. And I realized that maybe because of my weakness, I was given that so it could be turned in to a strength later. And because of that experience, I totally credit that for being able to do what I do now on this television show.
I probably left there anybody around that I found something that I truly passionately love to do. And working with my son and doing that, building up these cool airplanes is just good. You know, a bonus, a plus, you know. It's just like this great feeling of freedom that
Yeah, I've never got anywhere else in life, you know, this kind of feeling of freedom, you know.
When I told people, hey, I want to enlist in the Army, they looked at me like, really? Hannah Hogan, the cheerleader? She wants to go into the Army? And it was really cool to kind of break that stereotype where, you know, just because you're a girly really cheerleader doesn't mean you can't kick butt in the Army. All clear!
I expect for her to maybe one day, hopefully, become an NCO or maybe even an officer. She can go as far as she wants to go. The sky's the limit for her.
She just has that personality.
She has that personality. She has that strength.
You know, some of them, you gotta think like a fish.
You're not gonna find this beauty. You know, we're very spoiled over here in a way, and it's a special, special place. Even out of all the other islands, this island owns a lot more beauty.
In true Aloha fashion, he treated the crew to dinner at Grandma's house overlooking the bay. Ikaika lives what Hawaii is all about and seems to exemplify the spirit of aloha taught by his late grandmother, Annabelle.
What was her saying? If you stay longer than 2 minutes?
Yeah, 1 minute you guess, the next minute you family.
Oh, the bad ones hold on good, okay?
I'm 71, I'll be 72 in March.
You don't look 71 years old.
Thank you, I appreciate that. There's not enough time on this earth for me. Every morning when I get up, I think about what I want to do and what to do.
Believe in what you have, and that's where it's like your faith and timing and just believing in yourself and what you have. It's all going to come together.
Prior to Sister Act, Wanu was touring, just coming from Alaska, after this heading to Japan. Trista was doing a different musical in New York. I had stumbled upon two incredibly accomplished performers.
Before this, I actually was in Rochester doing Little Shop of Horrors. So I do different shows here and there. The Lion King on Broadway and on tour.
He had been on dialysis for 3 years.
He just couldn't hardly say anything. And I remember all of a sudden I felt like I was 10 feet tall. I hadn't felt like that in years. I felt like I had won the Super Bowl. And so I just grabbed him and I gave him a big hug and I just said, you're gonna be okay, dude. You're gonna be okay, I can do this.
And suddenly it became about someone else, the miracle of life Scott was giving to Marco, who has become a husband and father and Scott's close friend.
I now started my own little family. I was able to get married. Scott was at my wedding, it was amazing. Now I have two children, just things that I couldn't do back then that I can do now because I feel like, just kidding, but he did. One thing that he did, it changed my whole life.
Just normal, everyday, boring people. There is no such thing. Over 12 seasons, 50 states, hundreds of interviews, 14 Emmy Awards, I think we've proven that everyone has a great story. Mark Twain said, there was never yet an uninteresting life. Such a thing is an impossibility. Inside the dullest exterior, there is a drama, a comedy, and a tragedy. So please believe that you have a story. And everyone who went before you in your family has a great story. And it has impacted your life, and it has gotten you here. And that's how we've all ended up in this room. And that's when I say, and Daniel Taylor says, stories that you've never heard have dramatically impacted your life. That's what he means, that's what I mean. So let's think about how we all ended up here today. Let's think about how I ended up here today. And that's thanks to some ancestors of mine who toiled and fought and trekked and sailed. And these are stories that I didn't even know about. I knew about none of these ancestors until 15 years ago when my parents had both passed away and I'm digging through some stuff in my basement. And I find some of these stories. So, my clicker is no longer working. I'm pressing volume, that's why. John Leslie Norton. He came to Utah On July 24th, 1847, he was asked by Brigham Young to join that first group. I had no idea. Didn't know anything about this until 15 years ago. Interesting little fact. Guy by the name of Isaac Morley was one of the first members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints to make the pioneer trek in 1848, came to Utah. Albert Smith lived in Nauvoo, Illinois. I'm paid to speak for a living. And I do that. And he started the trek west, but he joined the Mormon battalion along with his son, and they got diverted, ended up in California. And his son actually was at Sutter's Mill when gold was discovered. And that didn't work out too well for my family for some reason, because they went on to Utah. What was wrong with them? It's all right. I'm happy to be here. Jens Peter Hansen was in the Danish Navy, and then he sailed to the United States, then trekked to Utah in 1858. Well, then let's fast forward a lot of years, and my wife's ancestors also made it to Utah. Look at that group. Isn't that amazing? This is my most important story. So we have four daughters. And my oldest is now married, so got to update that picture with a son-in-law. But that is why I do everything. That is my guiding force. And when I do anything, I think about them and the impact on them. And I have a really cool job, but I would give it up in a second if it meant losing my family, because that's what's most important to me. That's my most important story. To finish the story out as to how I ended up here, some guy named Rod watched a TV show and thought it'd be interesting to have a dorky TV host come and talk to you guys. So our stories are all connected somehow, even stories that we have not heard, stories that you haven't heard. They all connect us. We are all intertwined. What's your most important story? What do you do when everything hits the fan? What's the story you are constantly telling yourself? We all have a narrative that's playing in our minds. Lance talked about this. It affects everything we do. I'm lazy. I'm full of energy. I'm angry. I'm happy. I love life. I don't deal with problems very well. You know what? I can cope with whatever comes at me. Whether you're openly verbalizing your story or not, you are sending out the vibes all the time. And people can feel it. Call it an aura. Call it a countenance. You are impacting other people with your story all the time, even if you're not speaking your story. In 2012, the dot on the map hit a tiny little town called Refugio, Texas. Has anybody heard of Refugio? Not a single hand. I have had a hand raised before, and it's blown my mind. I'd never heard of Refugio. Went there, did an episode, got some great stories, figured I would never be back to Refugio, Texas. And if you go to Refugio, Texas, you'll understand why you wouldn't ever go back to Refugio, Texas. In 2017, I saw on the news as I was watching coverage about Hurricane Harvey, Refugio, Texas was going to take a direct hit. I knew I would have to go back.
Special players help us win a lot of games.
One of the first people I met back in 2012 was head football coach Jason Herring.
I have tons of energy, and I absolutely love what I do. I love these kids all the way from my star tailback to my fifth string offensive lineman. I try to treat them all the same.
Tell Chris!
We found it interesting that Coach Herring had nicknames like Coach Satan and the most hated man in Texas football.
Yeah! Yeah!
No doubt, Coach Herring is intense.
Gosh, dang it! Dad, tell me we gotta catch the football! You can't be scared!
But I learned it's Coach's intensity, his passion, his incredible commitment to excellence that transfers to his players. And the team never lets up. Even with third string players, they just keep scoring and winning like they did in the state championship just before my first visit.
Finished a perfect 15-0, and also along the way, we set the all-time scoring record of 891 points in a single season.
If you're on the other side of that, it's hard to like it. But I found Coach Herring to be one of the most exceptional men I've ever met.
Hey, how you doing, bud?
Coach.
How you doing? Good to see you.
Fantastic. Good to see you. Hard to believe it's been 5 years.
I'm sorry a hurricane is bringing me back here.
That's okay. There's been a lot of good that have come out of it.
And he's responsible for much of it.
You better have me ready to wear a lot of different hats if you're going to be the coach here, because football's only about that much. And now that the hurricane's hit, I'm telling you, football's about that much.
Get whatever you need, okay, buddy? Take your time to go through and get whatever you want, all right, buddy?
Up above the practice facility.
Down here, we've got the diapers that were donated and all the bedding. We've got pillows, bleach, paper towels, everything you can imagine that people have donated. And it's all nice, 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 brand new stuff.
Well, I came up here before, like, whenever we had got back, I came up here. Coach Train brought me and my sister and my brother up here, and we just got anything we needed. He gave us anything we wanted, and it's really special for everyone to come together and bring us all this stuff.
Is this all in the job description of football coach, school teacher?
I don't know how this came up, guy. You know what, Haas? I've always loved kids, and I've always loved people. And I just have a heart for people. I mean, I'll be honest with you, Haas, these last 4 weeks have probably been the most stressful, time-consuming months and weeks of my life. But no question, they've been the most rewarding. Absolutely no. I'm getting to be Santa Claus. I mean, it's unbelievable. I'm getting to do what I've always wanted to do, but I don't have the means to do.
He doesn't know how or why it happened, but Coach Herring became the relief coordinator for the town.
Now we're focusing on rebuilding, because that kids, they, most of them didn't have insurance. They don't have the means. I mean, life was hard anyway.
We lost our house, and we lost pretty much everything.
So we're putting on roofs, we're buying roofs, we're buying doors, we're buying windows, we're buying school clothes. God's just been great to us.
Yeah! Good. Very nice.
In spare time, coaches football.
Very nice. That's it.
But the game that has defined this town had to take a timeout.
Harvey hits Friday night. We're supposed to scrimmage. We canceled that. The next Friday, we're supposed to play Hebronville in Hebronville. We had to cancel because I didn't even know if my kids were alive or back.
After the storm, people were desperately trying just to get back to normal. And the most normal thing this town has is football. Friday nights, under the lights, watching a game.
Good! Good, Jerry! Good!
We intentionally played the very next Friday just for the kids, just for the community. We didn't start school for 3 weeks, but we started football and volleyball. So that the kids in the community would have something to hang their hat on. It's what drives our community, it's what drives our kids. Honestly, it's what drives me.
I've told you every single week, no storm or nothing can take away what we're good at, right? That's why we started football so soon after the storm, all right? Okay, I want you to play your guts out. I want you to remember how much I love you. I love you and I'm proud of you. Get your prayer.
Lord, we're so grateful for your blessings.
Coach Herring says the blessings have been flowing since day one. This game at Yorktown is a perfect example of those blessings that are bigger than a game.
Well, on the behalf of Yorktown ISD Student Council, we raised $427.50.
Golly, that's awesome. Thank you.
This happens at every game. Sportsmanship at its best.
I appreciate you, bud. A lot of class.
Jason Herring has a story that's bigger than football. It is his faith, it's his family, it's his students. And football is somewhere there, but it's lower than the rest of these things. And I think because he lives his higher story, his most important story, it makes him a better football coach, if that makes sense. and a Texas high school championship. Does anybody know anything about Texas high school football? That's a big deal. And I'm getting into a bit of a draw here because I heard that story. He's been recruited by a lot of schools to go and coach for them because it's a big stinking deal to win multiple championships like he's done. But he says, I can't leave. I cannot leave these kids. I cannot leave this community. Like he says, being a football coach in a tiny town like this, you're so much more than a football coach. He is a leader in that community. And he's getting kids out of bed in the morning to get them to school. Not just football players, but kids who rely on him, families who rely on him. And he's living his higher, more important story. It's important that you record your stories. It's important that you teach your students to record their stories. Don't wait for me to knock on your door. It's not going to happen. It is statistically impossible that I will knock on your door. What are your stories? Maybe you're not sure what your story is. Maybe you're not sure where to start. Just think about the good times, the bad times, the defining moments in your life, the scary times in your life, the heartwarming moments in your life. And today, the ability to capture stories is so much easier than ever before. I have a journal of one of these great-great-great-grandfathers, Albert Smith, who was in the Mormon Battalion. Fascinating to read that he had to scribble it out on paper. You don't have to do that anymore. You can just grab your phone and press record, and you have an amazing record of some moment. You can ask Grandma, so how'd you meet Grandpa? You know, something as simple as that. And it can be a priceless memory with little effort. I have actually even created an app. It's called Capture. It's a journaling app. C-A-P-C-H-U-R, by the way. It's free. So if you don't like it, get a full refund. There's my social media if you want to look me up. Everything's pretty much tripping with Todd, except for Facebook. And that can even be tripping with Todd. My personal site on Facebook is tripping with Todd. But you can find Capture somewhere on that mess of social media. But it's so important that you capture your story and the stories of those you love, because stories are so powerful. Stories change lives. Stories, as we've heard from Lloyd Newell, can improve your mood, they can improve your health. Researcher Marshall Duke says, from Emory University, says, kids who know family stories tend to be more resilient, have higher levels of self-esteem, more self-control, better family functioning, lower levels of anxiety. Is anxiety a problem in schools these days? Fewer behavioral problems and better chances of good outcomes when faced with challenges. Seems like plenty of great reasons to tell your story. So tell your story. It could change your life. It could change someone else's life. Put down your phone. Even though I'm saying use your phone with the app that I've created called Capture to record your story. But put down your phone, turn off the TV, turn off the computer. Have a face-to-face conversation with somebody, and that could change your life. Stories save lives. I've done stories with people. We don't have the time to show the story, but I've done stories with people. The mere fact that this lady told her story about having Lyme disease in the clinic that she went to in Pocatello, Idaho, it has now saved lives from people who have now gone to that clinic. And the guy who runs the clinic, Dr. J, Jason West, says thousands of people have now gotten help because she told her story. And I just happened to bump into the first person I saw in McCammon, Idaho. So stories change lives, stories save lives, and your stories create ripples, as Ashley McQuivey said in that story, that impact others. The way I approach my show, and I'm a spiritual dude, so I approach it with the idea that everybody's a child of God. And I don't know that everybody, every reality TV show host approaches their show like that. That's what I do. And so I think there's incredible worth with every person I see. And so when BYU TV says, what's your drop rate? There is no drop rate. Nobody should be dropped. Every person has worth. So what I hope people get from watching my silly little show, from this dorky dude, shy kid who grew up in Pleasant Grove, who, this shouldn't be my story, but it is. By God's grace, I'm here. Is that I hope people will look at people differently. When you see people throughout the course of the day, when you interact with anyone, when you even catch a glimpse of somebody going by, before you judge them by the way they look or act or dress or what they say, maybe you ought to get to know them first. Understand what's really going on. Because there's always something else going on. And understand that they are important. They are special. They have a compelling story. And that person that you caught a glimpse of is worth getting to know. And that conversation could change your life. And more important than that, the person you see in the mirror every day, understand that that person, despite the narrative that you might be telling yourself every day, this person that I'm seeing in the mirror every day is important, is special, has a compelling story, and is worth getting to know. And that's what life is all about. Getting to know ourselves. And know that our story is always changing. So I do a story, I put it on the TV show. It's fun, it's nice, wrapped up with a little bow. The very next day, that story has changed. My story is changing. My television show is changing. So I've done this show for 12 seasons, 8, 9 years now. And now it's taking a dramatic shift, and it's changing. In January, you'll see how dramatically it's changing. So, to get back to what I love and my passion, because these stories, you, that's my passion. That's what I love. Just grabbing anybody and saying, tell me your story. It's so important. It's compelling, and I've seen it change so many lives. Just somebody saying, sure, I'll tell you my story. I probably don't have one, but I'll tell it. And then I get all these emails saying, wow, that story impacted me. I can't believe it. Oh, right here. That is so important. I've got to keep doing it. So I'm going to do it on my own. Doing the YouTube, if you've heard of that. I think it's a fad. Might die out, but I'm going to try. So if you follow on social media, I'll be announcing something fairly soon. So my story's changing. We'll be doing the thing on the BYU TV, but stories change. Your life can change. Be ready for it. If none of what I have said today resonates with you at all, and you think I'm maybe a little bit crazy, if you see me coming with the cameras, just humor me. Give me the time of day and let me prove you wrong. Let me prove that you indeed have a story. Thank you so much. Thank you.
We want to thank Santa for his time today, for him being, for his Times article, if you get a chance to look at it sometime, it's called The Stories That Bind Us. And that article I've shared over the years with people. I truly believe that our stories bind us. And you're about to have this experience with 200 and some students, could be 300, could be 12, depending on who you are and how many classes you're teaching. But when you have that experience, those 12 people, those 300 kids, are coming in and they are looking forward to seeing you, to meeting you and being a part of things with you. So I'm really grateful that our stories have bound us. You know, we're able to be a part of this with CTE, and we really appreciate Todd Hansen coming. We're going to give him this nice warm inky for his road trips. Yeah, he might need that. Tell him thanks a lot for coming. A couple of things. First off, we want to take a moment and introduce our coordinators. We'll do that here in just a second. I want to say a couple of things. You know, each of you this year, you know, you have students that are coming into your classrooms, and when you look at the trends right now in CTE, we've never been more relevant. There's never been a time where CTE has been more relevant. And I can't underscore that enough to you, because as you're seeing, you know, I was looking at some statistics the other day. When I went to college, I went to the College of Eastern Utah, and tuition was about $1,600. And tuition has gone up close to 300% since then. Health costs, and our salaries haven't, it turns out. You know, they haven't matched that trend. And so there's all kinds of alternatives for students. As you look around in this room, it's not just trade schools. It's a lot of your students will go to universities, but some will choose to go to trade schools. And if you look at the gaps between trade schools and university education, you're gonna see that there are two-year degrees where you're starting out at $90,000. And there are four-year degrees where you're starting out at $28,000. So you have this decision to make, and students need this sort of guidance, and they get it from you. And the exposure that you give them to opportunities, and the opportunities that you show them in the classroom to say, hey, here is something that you might want to do. We really want to encourage our counselors and you all to make sure that your area with confidence, that you're making it relevant. So take your students and help them understand that there are amazing things that they can do. And that gap will continue to widen until we close it, until we give students an opportunity to see, hey, this might be the best route for me. So there's lots of different things that students can do during the course of their careers. Let me know when that's... Okay, sorry. So there are great opportunities that are out there for students, and we really want to underscore those. Now, we have a number of different coordinators that are over different areas, and so I want to show you a quick video just really to introduce them. We also know that you oftentimes have questions of different nature about CTE, and so we want to recognize Susan Mindrum, who's the Secretary of CTE over here. She's been the star of the day, having heard everything. We really appreciate all she's done, and she's amazing. And Jody Kohler is here with us. She's the secretary there at Innovations. So we really appreciate them being here. And we've talked a little bit about, let me just see if I can find this. We've talked a little bit about the amazing things that happen in your classrooms, one of which is, see if I can find this. What's that? Oh, yes. Sorry. So let me just introduce you to some of our CTE coordinators. Thanks to Fred Smith and his crew for putting this together. That's something. Really, we want to thank Fred and his students for filming that. That's awesome. Give them a round of applause. And we found it hard to find a hat to fit Trevor. He had to hold that thing on like nobody's business, so there were a lot of funny things about that, but some of them have learned some great dance moves. So we just had them stand up. Trevor's in the back, he's over business and marketing. Appreciate Trevor. And Chad Marriott, agriculture. Todd Donnelly in engineering. Computer science. Jeff Meyer, is Jeff here? Jeff Meyer is our work-based learning. And if you look at some of the, if each of you get an opportunity sometime to look through here, you'll see the work-based learning is a part of every single one of you. We actually increased our work-based learning internships by over 40% this year. So we really want students to have exploration opportunities. And we had a chance to recognize Kobe Pack from Weber High School. Yeah, it was way cool. And Kobe Pack, it was a national winner in FBLA, and that's not the point of it. The point of it is, first of all, he had a junior high CTSO experience. He started out in FBLA at Snowcrest Junior High School. And from there, he went to Weber High School. And this is exactly what we want to see. We want to see that exploration, extension opportunities in the junior high schools, and then they move. And he had all these experiences going in there. And then he actually got an internship at White Clouds. And he was able to learn about 3D printing. And there, he was able to hone his presentation style, and he ended up winning the national title. I mean, he was first place in the nation. That's a great story to tell. But the best story of all is the social part of what he talked about when he was with the administrators that day. He talked about the importance of associating with others. So I know last year we talked about, hey, you know, let's see if we can widen the SWAT and get more kids involved in these things. We did it. Over 40% increase in many of our areas, 8 different CTSOs. So we want to see those continue. So work with your students to find more students to have that experience, because I thought the social experience he had was remarkable. Becky Sagers is over all of our facts and health programs. She's right back there. And she was the only one to feed an animal in that video, so that was good. Very, very good. She's a kind soul. Charlie Nielsen right here, over welding and automotive. So those are just a few experiences that we really want to push is our CTSOs. We've seen remarkable growth in a number of different areas, and we want to continue that. We really appreciate all you're doing. Continue to promote your programs. Let us know how we can help you do that. That's in part our job, is to make sure that you have all the support that you need. These coordinators are remarkable. You have them at your school level. They're just an earshot away, and we'll be there for you. And so if you have questions or things that we can do for you, talking about some of you young teachers with skills tests and things like this coming up, let us know how we can help you. We'll continue to promote. 3 of the 4 high schools now are on the same schedule. Roy High School is not, but you've got Bonneville, Roy, and Weaver all on the same schedule. So they can actually get together using those Google Hangouts. All of you should have a camera on your computer if you want to be able to do that. You can have virtual PLCs, or we can get together frequently. So I really want to promote that. A lot of your schools are going to do things with reading, writing, and things. I want to just, you know, I came across something. Bill Baggett this summer talked about rigor relevance, and he had a statistic, and I'll share it with you online, but CTE actually has the highest Lexile score of any of the readings that you come across. CTE. You know, you wouldn't expect it. Much higher than social studies, even English. You've got Lexile scores in automotive and engineering. So students, they have to know how to read. These are difficult texts. And a lot of times, stereotype of CTE is that these students, it's a lower level reading, that it's not. You've got highly technical reading with difficult things for them to comprehend, and it takes a great teacher to help them with this. And so we really encourage you to continue to stay relevant with those things. Get involved in school level initiatives. And so if you want to, when you're in your PLCs and you're talking about singleton areas where you don't have the same area that you're teaching, you know, focus on these employability skills. The things that Lance and Todd talked about today, tell your story. Listen to students' stories. Allow them to be able to do that. Those personal connections will go a long way for students to be able to learn. And there's a great deal of research out there about when students feel that connection with a teacher, they learn better. And so Todd's story today, talking about the importance of making that connection, is really, really relevant. When you look at the stories of both Todd and Lance, you have those students all in your classrooms. All of our stories are like that. My own is not much different than what they're talking about. And we all had people who showed a great deal of trust and faith in us and gave us a chance, gave us a pep talk for a minute, and told us that we were good at something. And in our low moments, we go back to that. We go back to the belief that someone believed in us, that they saw the best in us. And so you get to be that individual. Somewhere down the road, someone will tell that story of you believing in them. And that's how this is so special, what we're in. Education is a remarkable, remarkable profession. Not for one second do I regret becoming a teacher, being in education. It's where we can make a difference. Many of listening to our 22 first year teachers, almost all of them talked about leaving something and wanting to make a difference. That's why they're in this profession. Then we all know there are other alternatives, but we've chosen to be here because we can impact people like Todd, we can impact people like Lance, and people like me who may not have been, you know, you were an underdog at some point. And so people showing that sort of trust and faith in you is special, and you never forget those people. So grateful that we have had this day to be able to be together. If you have any questions or anything, I know that a lot of you have van trainings and things like this. It's going to get busy. We really appreciate all that you do. We're excited about an amazing school year. Each of you have a t-shirt or a shirt on the way out. And that shirt says family on it. CTE and its family. And that's how we look at these things, is that you know, this group is a family. We work together and we try to help each other, and I want you to feel that way. And so there's a shirt for you on the way out.